No, you've been thrown out, Pete.
Excuse me. Please join us for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First up, we have the oath of office for EMS Officer Nathan Denio. And do you want to come on up and...
Thank you. I appreciate you taking the time this evening to help me promote Nate Denio to the position of EMS Officer at the head of the fire department. Nate was our top tester, and he absolutely brings all the qualifications to bear for this office. We feel very proud with his promotion to EMS Officer. I know that he's going to bring our department to a new level for EMS delivery. So, without further ado, we'd like to welcome Nate and Ms. Cipher up for the oath of office.
From the town of Hampton in the county of Rockingham to Nathan Denio of Hampton, New Hampshire in the county of Rockingham. Whereas there is a vacancy in the office of Emergency Medical Services Officer in said town, and whereas we, the subscribers, have confidence in your ability and integrity to perform the duties of said office, we do hereby appoint you, the said Nathan Denio, as Emergency Medical Services Officer of said town. And upon your taking the oath of office and having this appointment and the certificate of oath of office recorded by the town clerk, you shall have the powers, perform the duties, and be subject to the liabilities of such office until another person shall be chosen and qualified in your stead. Given under my hand this 4th day of May, 2015, Fred Welch, Town Manager. Raise your right hand, repeat after me. I, Nathan Denio.
I, Nathan Denio.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
That I will faithfully and impartially.
Discharge and perform.
Discharge and perform.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
All the duties incumbent upon me.
As Emergency Medical Services Officer.
As Emergency Medical Services Officer.
According to the best of my abilities.
According to the best of my abilities.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Agreeably to the rules and regulations.
Of this Constitution.
Of this Constitution.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
And the laws of the state of New Hampshire.
So help me God.
So help me God.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Nate's been a member of the Hampton Fire Department since 1998, and he's been a paramedic since 2007. For the pinning on, we'd like to invite his daughter Nicole and his wife Jill to come up.
Mr. Denio, we want to congratulate you, thank you, thank all of you, thank the whole department, wonderful service, and we want to thank Peter Wall, the EMS officer
please
that you're replacing,
and shake everyone's
and hand. He's been great too, so we want to thank him.
Good job.
My favorite part of the department.
And I'd just like to say, I worked with Nate for about 8 of those years that he was there. Nate is a fine firefighter and a great paramedic, and he's going to do an excellent job servicing the Hampton Fire Department as their emergency medical officer. So,
thank you, sir.
Awesome.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Right.
Just about behind the Hampton Fire.
Oh, yeah.
Black shirt. He's one of the few.
Always house today for both.
There goes the audience. I didn't realize that Peter retired. I didn't get
yes.
A,
no. Yep.
Well, I know now because I talked to him.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't realize that he had to retire. But that's good, given his health. It's going to be good for him.
good man.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
Now move them outside. They are.
Push everyone out. Moving on to public comment. Anyone wishing to speak public comment, please join us.
Corrine Baker, 244 Exeter Road. I have been on the Recycling Education Committee, but I am not requesting reappointment to the committee. I've served for several years and can't commit to meetings or potential activities this year. I'm frustrated by the lack of enforcement of the mandatory recycling ordinance. It's something that we cannot do. And we seem to be still picking up overfilled green recycling carts with black plastic bags filled with who knows what, but it's still being picked up. I wrote a letter to the board, which I'll read. Sometime soon you will be deciding whether to allow the Recycling Education Committee to continue. I would ask that you vote to continue this committee. Members of the committee do continue to think of ways to decrease the amount of solid waste going into the landfill by increasing the diversion rate. The committee has no budget. Any flyers or other items distributed at various places in the town are either donated by committee members or from EcoMaine. We are a few residents who believe that with education we can make a difference. This past year, the committee functioned without benefit of a selectman representative. I would suggest that one of your members do take an hour a month to participate going forward. We have been meeting the second Tuesday of each month at 3 o'clock and try to wrap up by 4. Thank you for your consideration. I also have comments on two other subjects. Should I sit down and then come back or stay?
No, this is your time.
Okay. Last week, there was an article about the parking at North Beach, side streets in North Beach, and it mentioned that there were no restrooms at North Beach. Well, we all know that there is a restroom at North Beach, which serves that area wonderfully. And also, my next subject is Exeter Road. I don't know what I can say about that, but, you know, the job of the town of Hampton exists, the employees and boards and committees of the town of Hampton serve the town of Hampton. And I just do not think that the work on Exeter Road is serving not only the residents here, but anybody who travels there. For the 10,000 vehicles that travel that section of road from Route 101 down to 1, 10,000 vehicles a day. It is just not being cared for the way it should be. So I don't know whether I could work with somebody on the Board of Selectmen or with Mr. Welch to put together a warrant article for next year and possibly get a bond so that we can fix that road the way it needs to be fixed. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak? After Mr. Pierce.
Oh, thank you. Mike Pierce, 84 Lock Road, recently moved from 16 Hedman, which was quite an ordeal. But putting that aside, recent situation with the assessor not showing up at the planned appointment to Budget Committee April 21st highlights the ongoing situation in which the selectmen are making decisions inappropriately outside the public meetings, having transparency issues and ignoring the right to know law, their own personnel and purchasing policies. Example, Ed Tinker was scheduled to attend the April 21st Budget Committee meeting. I don't know exactly what went on outside the public meetings, have stories have been inconsistent. But apparently, Selectman Griffin Bean and Waddell decide he should not attend, a clear violation of the right to know law. Selectman Waddell first said he wasn't involved, then acknowledged he was, and the assessor was placed in a very awkward position of being, when asked by the newspapers and members of the Budget Committee and other selectmen why he didn't attend the initial agreed meeting to be there, agreeing to be there. Item number two, the assistant town manager position was decided completely in non-public. There's no basis for having a non-public meeting and decide to eliminate the assistant town attorney position and add the assistant town manager slot. And briefly, some other issues. The town assistant town manager position was not posted for the minimum 1 week required by the personnel policy. This is the selectman's policy, not anybody else's. The $2 million Xterra settlement was approved by the selectman on the consent agenda with no explanation by the selectman to the public of your positions behind this major shift of the tax burden. In March, the selectman approved entering into a trash disposal agreement with EcoMaine without a competitive bid. Waste management pointed out to you, you violated your own personal purchasing policy. And I had to make a right-to-know law request, including a $50 fee just to obtain copies of the budget and the fire union tentative agreements, items that in the past had been proactively posted on the town web by the selectmen. In summary, transparency, abiding by the statute right-to-know law, and honesty, sadly, are missing from some of the current board members' mode of operation. Thank you.
Anyone else wishing to speak?
Hello, everyone. My name is Charles Locke. I live on Winnicott Road. And I'd like to put forth, I've been trying for 7 years now to get a bathhouse. I've been working with the state, and there's always pushback. And we make a lot of money here on the beach. The state makes a lot. At the end of Winnicott Road, there is two islands. As you're heading to the seawall, the island to the right would be a perfect spot for a very small bathroom. Parents are coming down with their children with cots, full of kids, no place for them to go to the restroom. Where they once went to Lupo's, there's not a spot for them now. There's not even a spot for them to change if they have young children in diapers. And being that they're paying the taxes that they are, I think we should try and put a push towards a very small. I even asked for porta potties, but nobody wants to see something like that. But, and my one other point would be the do not litter signs at each post where people are paying for the parking. If that could just be a sign there, no littering. I walk that wall all the time, and I always pick it up, and I put everybody's trash. I don't mind doing it, but I'd like to have some. Do they get enough signs? The state put up enough signs for the feeding meters. I'd like a few signs for no littering. That's it. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Just so that you know, that is a state issue. So you need to.
But if you guys could push it.
Yeah. We'll be glad to push it, but it doesn't work that way. You know, basically, if you made your feelings noted to the state, it might help.
I've been doing that for 6 years.
Okay.
I've spoke with Ms. Stells, Mr. Mums, Mr. Fuller, and I've had callbacks as well. And they just say, well, we're going to have to put it in the budget for following year. And that's the story I keep receiving. So I'm just asking for a little help from you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak at public comment? Seeing none, we'll move to the announcements and community calendar. Mr. Waddell?
All set, nothing.
Mr. Bridle?
All set, thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I want to welcome back my wonderful neighbors from their very tough winter in Florida. They've come back up here to recover.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you. I'd like to welcome back my good friend, Mr. Bridle, who's come back from Florida.
Thank you.
It's good to have you back, Rusty. Just perambulating throughout the town this past weekend. It's 80 degrees. People are having wedding showers. Kids are playing on the athletic fields. The beaches are full. The decks are full. I was down on Seabrook Beach this morning. Katie Landscape is setting up their gear for doing the cleaning of the beach. The state, for what they do, has done a tremendous job in preparing that beach and how it looks, the infrastructure improvements we've all done, and our collaborative efforts for the gains we've achieved are really remarkable. This is a remarkable town. It is an absolutely fantastic town, and it's the season to be in a good mood, and notwithstanding the potholes and notwithstanding personal challenges once in a while, this is a fantastic community to live and to work in. Thank you.
And I'd like to mention about the passing of a woman that watched these meetings every Monday night, Kathy Larkin, that lived on Sicard Road. She was a great person. She worked with the Seacoast VNA for many years, and she was her focus, I think, was sugar diabetes, helping people that needed to help at the beginning or whenever they had issues with that. But she helped a lot of people get their medicine and stuff like that with help from different churches. So she was a great person to be there, a real old-fashioned nurse. And she did pass away this week, and she is being waked at 3 to 5 on Saturday at Remix. Thank you. Moving on to the consent agenda.
Also move, Mr. Chairman, the parade permit for the New Hampshire Towing Association, May 17th, 2015.
Second that.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Our first appointment tonight is Senator Nancy Stiles. Please join us.
Beat up on those germs, Nancy.
I think I finally turned the corner.
I didn't think a germ was brave enough to go near you.
Well, thank you, and I'm pleased to be with you this evening. Apologize that I couldn't have been with the rest of the team a couple of weeks ago, but some things I just didn't have control over. I did hear the message this evening about the bathrooms. That is an issue. I don't think that we're going to see any bathrooms at the end of Winnicott Road for a variety of reasons. I will follow up on that, but I can speak to Parks about the no-litter signs. That shouldn't be too much of an issue. Tonight, I'd just like to speak to you about four bills that I've been working on that I think will have an impact in one way or another on Hampton. And the first one I will speak to is Senate Bill 242, which you addressed last week, which is the adoption of the budget through the Senate SB2 process. As we know, SB2 has been in play for a while, and it seems to be getting less and less people that attend the deliberative session to make decisions about the budget. I put that bill in for one of the Hampton constituents, and I thought he had a great solution. Unfortunately, I got it through the Senate without too much trouble, even though the Municipal Association came in and did all they could to oppose it. But when it got over to the House, that individual really did a number on it, and I met with him after the fact and told him I was not at all happy with his analogy to the process. So the way it stands right now is I'm working with the chair of the House Committee and the vice chair of the House Committee and one of the reps over there who also had a bill put forward that was looking at the default budget. So we're looking to merge the two bills together and actually sit down and take a look at the process, the adoption, the amendments to the budget and the default, how the default gets put forward, and then come out with some recommendations maybe in November of 2015. And therefore, any of that would go forward in 2016. But I do think it's time to take a look at it. I've had some people suggest to me that we just do away with the deliberative session and just go forward with what you guys do. I think all of that will be part of the discussion. Another one of the Hampton constituents called me with some other ideas, which I took note of, and I will take to the study committee when it gets formed and comes out of the House. The second bill I wanted to speak to you about is the capital budget. I've been working with the president and with one of my key colleagues in the Senate to put forth in the capital budget this year an amount of money to purchase some land for the Hampton Court. As you know, Hampton Court was closed because of mold and so forth, and was put in a temporary location in Seabrook. It is totally undersized for what we need. The Court Accreditation Committee came to me last fall and asked me if I would put forth a piece of legislation, and I recommended that they have the accreditation team put it forward, that I would co-sponsor it. But if I put it forward, I thought it looked too self-serving, and so the senator who sits on the accreditation team put forth to split the Hampton and Exeter courts. So Exeter would stay in Brentwood. We have a chapter law that says that the Hampton court will be cited, says by January 1st of 2015. I have been looking for land for the Hampton court for 8 years. I've had my hand around five pieces of land at different times. They've all been privately owned. It's very difficult to get someone to hold on to a piece of land while the legislature goes through the process to decide whether or not they're going to buy it. This time I have got my hands on a piece of state property. Ooh. That has been designated available. And so I've been working with DOT and with administrative services and with the governor's office and with the president and with the capital budget to put in an amount of money to secure some land. It would only secure the land in the capital budget, and in the next capital budget there would have to be an appropriation for engineering and building of the courthouse, but that would begin to bring the Hampton Court back to Hampton. So that's another piece I've been working on. Senate Bill 213, the meals and rooms tax study. Hopefully it's going to a study committee. There's been a lot of discussion, debate, and everything else over that piece of legislation. And this year also, Senator Clark put in a piece of legislation to allow local communities to put a local tax on hotel occupancy if they wanted to. So what we did was we merged those two bills so that we would have all of the same people at the same table at the same time discussing the same issue to look at, do we change the distribution formula for meals and rooms tax, or do we enable communities to do something different? Is there some other way to help those communities that actually have to push it down on the local taxpayer to support tourism? We currently have 8,479 businesses that contribute to the business and meals tax. Meals and rooms tax, excuse me. 106 of those communities have less than 5 businesses. 28 communities have 1. 17 communities have 100 or more. And according to the data that I received from a reliable source, Hampton has 353 businesses that contribute to the meals and rooms tax. And so I explained to the House Ways and Means Committee that, you know, what it is causing the money to be pushed down the local taxpayer. And I think it's $1.8 million. Is that correct, Fred?
Yes.
$1.8 million that gets pushed down on the local taxpayer. So do we need to begin to look at this distribution, which was put into place in 1967? Doesn't hurt to take a look at current legislation to, you know, see if does it need to be changed in some fashion, and have that discussion. I think I have moved them. I called the chair of Ways and Means on Sunday, and I said, I have to go before my board on Monday night. Can I tell them that it will come out of your committee in the form of a study committee? His response was, we haven't fully discussed it, Nancy, but I feel pretty sure that it will come out as a study committee. I've spoken with the House Speaker and the Chief of Staff in the House and told them I want a study committee out of 242. So that should be coming out within a week or two out of the committee and on the floor of the House. And the final one that I've, number four that I've been working on, is Senate Bill 191. I hope I can explain this clearly to what it does. I've been working on this with Senator Preston, Bob Preston, for a couple of years now, and we think we finally got it to a place that we can move it forward. The state has piloted the purchase card with a couple of their agencies last year and have decided to move forward with all of the agencies in the state. That means that you would have a credit card that would be called a purchase card, and it would be from one central bank. Okay, let me read this, because I asked Mike, I said, Mike, send me the actual language so I make sure I get it right to them. Municipalities and school districts, as well as village districts, could participate if they choose. Now, my first question to them was, how does a community get in, and how do they get out? I need to know both of those things. And that it would be by the contract year. Now, you use the state bid on some of the items, like salt and those things, I believe. Right. And the state actually puts about 100 items out to bid. And if they knew what everybody was going to want or participate with, they may be able to get a better price for the communities as well as the state. So that's the first piece of it. SB 191 is currently in House Finance, and I've been told they're thinking about massaging it a little bit, and I'm not too happy with the massage. So we'll see how that goes. What it sets out to do, if a community or district chooses to participate, using the state procurement card, districts would be responsible for paying their own bills directly and not through the state. So you'd have a credit card, and you'd pay the bank that owned the credit card, but it would be one that everyone in the state had the opportunity to use. And you would get your rate back from that spend, whatever your spend is. And the average average on the spend, I think, is like 1.4% you get back. I think that's about the average. But if you used all of the communities together, if they all worked together in a collective manner, then there would be a bonus piece. And let me see if I can explain this a little bit clearer. Say an individual district was to spend $1 million on this card. They would receive 1.04 rebate, so that's about $10,400. With the if you combine it with the state spend, which is over $18 million, that would qualify for a higher rebate of 1.44. So you would get a bonus on top of what your normal spend would be, and your additional amount of money would be about $7,200, which would go directly to you. Now, if we could have several doing it, the highest rate, I think, is 1.76. And so you get whatever you spend, you would get that, and you would get it at the 1.76 rate instead of the 1.04. And then collectively, what is spent would be a bonus, and you would get 50% of that bonus would go back to your community based on what your spend is, And then another portion would go to another 50% would go to the state to pay for the person doing the work in the state, the administration of it, and the balance of that would go to the state's unfunded unfunded liability. I'm trying to get the unfunded liability paid a little bit quicker than it is currently. And if many participated and we could pay off that unfunded liability or pay it up, then it would also help to keep your rates down. So it's kind of a complicated thing, but I hope I made myself clear on how it would work. I just think it's an opportunity, not required. You can participate if you want to. You don't have to participate if you don't want to. You can participate for a period of time. I said, how often will that go out to bid? It will go out every 5 years. So if you made a commitment, it would be like a 5-year commitment. At the end of 5 years, you can throw it aside if you don't want it. Or you don't have to take it at all. But I just thought it was a way to get additional money into the communities without taxing people. So those are the four bills that I've really been working quite hard on this year, and I am open to any questions.
We'll give you some questions. Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, thank you, Senator. Thanks for your service.
213, that's the important one, isn't it?
213, the meals and rooms tax.
Meals and meals, yeah.
Yeah, they were going to kill it, and I begged for a study committee, so.
All right, I mean, does it, the Senate's more open to it than the House, or?
I got it through the Senate, and I voice vote.
Okay. And do you have many allies in the House to?
House is a different place this year.
I know it is.
And so I trust my partners here in the reps to work it through. And they all really are pretty well staggered so that they have different factions involved and they have different committees involved. And so they do great stuff. I wouldn't take it away from them because they do,
right.
They do great
right.
stuff.
Right. No, I agree 100%. But it's just, as you know, and you've worked on it for so long. Thank you for working on it. 191 sounds complicated.
It sounds good. I think it needs to be, and that's why I can leave this with you. And he gave me a long list of, you know, if your spend was a certain amount, what the bonus would be.
It'd be interesting to look at and get some more information on it. Yeah. It sounds good.
Because Senator Preston, it was actually his idea. He brought it to me. And so he and I have been working on it for a couple of years now, trying to get it polished up so that we could try to move it forward.
Very good. In budget, will it change a lot?
I think it will change.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do think it will change. The Senate operates a little bit differently than the House does. The House only had 3 weeks. So, I mean, you have to give them credit to try to pull everything together in 3 weeks. They have only 3 weeks to do that. We have a couple of months to do that in the Senate because it comes over to us at the end of March. We have until the end of May to actually pull the budget together. And we also have the revenue from March and April to better understand. Right now, the revenue is running ahead. We're about $35 million ahead when it comes to the budget. The Senate did pass a piece of legislation, 24-0, to not raid the dedicated funds. So it should be interesting to see how we manage this process as we go through. One thing I like about the way that the Senate does it, because they look at the governor's budget, they look at the House's budget, and then they just take into consideration what the Senate Ways and Means has identified as the revenue. And I called the chair of the Senate Ways and Means the other day, and I said, have you come up with a number yet? Are we the same as the House, or more or less, or the same as the governor? Where are we in the process? He said, we're not there yet, and it'll be another couple of weeks before we actually determine what the actual revenue projection would be. Mm-hmm. And then what the Senate does is they actually speak to every senator, and they say, what are your priorities for the budget? Give me your list of priorities. So in the different areas, economic development, education, health, all of those things, I listed my three priorities in each group of what I saw were important to make sure we included in the budget. Now I'm only one of 24 senators. Will I get all of them? Probably not. Will I get one or two or three? Maybe. Although the chair did tell me she liked everything that I put in except for one thing. So I'm hoping.
Pretty good. Thank you.
Mr. Bridle?
Thank you, Nancy. It's always good to see you here, and thank you for all you do up to Concord. I just got back from a trip from Florida, and I stayed in 6 different states, and every one of them had a local tax. There's no reason why we can't start doing that here and building up our taxes, you know, for the towns that actually support the revenue that comes in.
Well, that may be one of the things that comes out of the study committee. I know when Senator Clark put that bill in, she had put it in at $1 per hotel room. And everybody went after her and said it has to be occupied. You can't expect the business to pay for something that, you know, so it would be occupied. It would be occupied. Now, whether they would stick with the dollar or whether they would stick with the percentage, I don't know what it would be.
Every one of the 6 states I did, it was a percentage.
Yeah.
And they varied different amounts for the different states, but each one of them had that.
The gal from the Municipal Association came in and supported the bill, and she also had the list of all of the local state charges, the state charges for the local tax.
The second thing, I had a young lady hit me up tonight before I got in here, talking about painting a crosswalks down the beach on the boulevard. In particular, the one, and I think it's about 581 Ocean Boulevard, in front of Royal Sands, Contel. That one has not been painted in a couple of years. And she was very concerned about her grandchildren and stuff going across the road there, and not only the grandchildren, but herself also. And so I suggested that she contact you, but I also suggested that you were going to be here tonight. So, but she was very concerned with that one. Oh. I know in the years past we've had some difficulty getting the sidewalks done, but the crosswalks, but we really need to see if we can get them to step
okay,
up.
Okay, and I will get back to you on that one specifically.
Okay.
And then you can get back to her.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Mrs. Wolsey.
Could I ask Rusty, what do they call the tax that you said you saw? That
there was
a name for it?
I can bring in the bills. Some was a local hospitality tax. Some was a local rooms tax.
Oh.
So okay. Everyone had a little different.
But a tax is a tax.
A tax is a tax, yeah. But it was specifically for the community in which it was raised in.
That's good information. Good evening, Nancy. Thank you so much for being here. I have a few things. The one thing that concerned me, and I spoke briefly with you on SB 242, I just wondered if it might inhibit the public from making amendments. I can see if there was one amendment, like the amendment that came in and said, let's increase the budget by X amount. But if people were inclined to make smaller amendments at the deliberative session, I'm wondering if that might not end up by being a bit too complicated.
I don't know, but I would, honestly, when this committee gets formed, I would like to have selectmen come up and speak to the committee and share your experience and what you see as issues from your side of the table. I'd like to have citizens from the individual towns come in and speak. I think it's if you live in an SB2 town, it is easier to understand what's going on than the individual who.
The participation is so definitely vocal. Dropping off, as you mentioned, because I asked you a couple of years ago to see SB2 versus the old town meeting, and you said it seemed about the same. So,
one of the things that one of the Hampton residents suggested was maybe you should require a certain percentage of the voters to be at the table in order to make amendments.
In order to conduct business. So,
at the deliberative session.
I have a couple of really quick things for you. Two, 3 years ago, the state sponsored a Route 1A, 1B study, and they were talking about possibly getting signs, you know, beautifying, making it consistent with New England so everybody would be happy to come to 1A, and also putting signage directing individuals to uptown businesses, you know, at High Street, go here, you'll go to Route 1 and see nice stuff. I don't see anything happening there, but one thing that I have had questions about, talking about 1A and 1B, is evacuation signs. I don't know if that's something the state, I know people get upset at signs, but I don't know if that's something that the state would like to consider. And really high on the priority list for the state, apparently, is the New Hampshire 1A bridge between Seabrook and Hampton. I'm hoping the legislature is looking to enlarging the bridge at some point in time if we can ever get the money. But since that is a primary evacuation route, it might not hurt. So I just thought I would share that with you for whatever good it does. Also, talking about the Route 1A, there's a huge problem, and Mr. Griffin can speak to that better than I can, on drainage on 1A. He can talk to you a long time about the problem with drainage on 1A. And I guess some, Fred, the federal government was ready with funding and it fell through with the state somehow. That's a huge problem for this town. So once again, I don't expect you to work magic in Concord, but it's something to think about. I've had a lot of complaints, and we have as a board when we had the hearings for North Beach and the main beach on problems that they're having, dog waste. It's a health hazard as well as something that doesn't look very nice. I notice when I go down to PetSmart in Seabrook, Well, you park in the parking lot, and you get to the place where you're just going to cross the road and go into the store, and there's a little metal stand, and it says something like doggy station or something on it, and it's got bags that you can pull out for, you know, and a little container that I guess you can put the waste in. I'm sure that the people down in that particular mall don't want dog all over the place. I'm wondering if the state could consider putting some of those along 1A, along the sidewalk. You have a lot of dogs down there, and I've had a lot of people complaining about the carelessness in disposing of the waste.
I know that they have them along the beach, along the some of the entryways into the beach. They have them there. I know that they have them up in Northampton as well. I've seen them up there with the bags that you pull out.
Oh, okay.
The thing is to get the people to use them.
Can we bring in the National Guard?
But I'll speak to them to see if there's anything else they can do.
See if we can enhance the use of those, maybe. And then two other quick things. Smoking. People go to the beach for sort of being healthy. And I know that people walk along, say, North Beach, and you walk along the seawall, and people are out there going puff, puff, puff. I'm guessing that you can't make a provision that's relevant to just one of the state parks. If you were going to discuss with the legislature a ban on smoking in state parks, I'm assuming you'd have to have that applicable to all of them. And in Hampton, there's probably no real forest fire danger, but I imagine in some of our state parks that could be a consideration. People will probably get upset at that thought, but if you're going to the beach, you're taking a walk along the beach, trying to be healthy and going along and getting the nice ocean breezes, and then you're choking to death on the smoke, plus the cigarette butts thrown all over the place. Just a thought for you, and I know you've got your hands full up there, but you were nice enough to come in. And the last item I have is two quick things, sorry. Is it possible to ask DOT, please, because some of the comments I think people made, to paint no parking here to corner at the ends of the numbered streets? We're told we can't do it, because 1A isn't us. But it's a huge danger when people are just parking close to the corner and then nobody can get out, and it's hazard prone, to say nothing of getting emergency vehicles. I would hope DOT could maybe use up a little paint and just try to paint the corners that abut 1A. And last one is the seawall. You and I spoke a couple of years ago on the seawall, the money to finish the last portion of it, which is now pretty near complete. And I said, Nancy, it's going to be insufficient with weather conditions, what's happening with the ocean, storms, etc. And that's a very vulnerable part of the town. You mentioned something about we'll finish the seawall to try to mend it now and set up a commission. Any hope of having a little type of some kind of study commission on the on redesigning and enhancing the seawall?
Okay, let me try to address some of your questions. I'll start at the bottom and work backwards.
Oh, bless your heart.
As far as establishing a commission, there is a commission that Representative Cushing, Representative Rice, and I, and Representative Waters sit on. It's the surge flooding, sea level rise, and all of that. I would think that that would be an appropriate place to have that discussion.
Good.
So I can take that to that commission. We have a steering committee meeting on Friday, I think it is, so I will bring it up at that point.
I appreciate that.
Okay. DOT painting to the corners, I can ask that when I talk about the sidewalks.
That would be wonderful. Well, it seems like a no-brainer, but then again.
Smoking, no smoking on the beaches. It's been a big discussion since... what was her name?
In the parks, basically.
She lived.
Yeah.
No, she lived over in the Purple House on Mill Road.
Oh. I know who you mean. Yes, that's
Kepner?
Great.
Kepner.
Kepner.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She was all over that issue. Yeah. And I believe what State Parks did this past year was they piloted at one or two of the sites. I think it was... the one near Franconia, the beach area near Franconia,
uh-huh.
And I don't know where the other one was, but I also sit on the State Parks Advisory Committee, so I don't think we're having a meeting until the fall, unfortunately, but I can see what's going on with that. I know that down here it is the cigarette butts on the on the beach is what it is, but
oh, not just the beach, the sidewalk, everywhere. And I think it's not just the beach areas of the state parks, but all the areas, because we don't have a forest fire danger here, but they, I'm sure, do up country.
Yeah, and I know that there's been some discussion about, you know, how much is the government going to tell you can or you can't do? But there was also some discussion about maybe having, at each facility, having a place where people could go to smoke like
and
they
you
do
can
in
control
airports
it.
And so forth like that.
Good.
So that'll probably still be under discussion. The dog waste bags, I think I spoke to that. The drainage has been a problem. I had a conversation just most recently about drainage. I think when we redo Ocean Boulevard, that's when all of the drainage will be replaced, fixed.
When we redo it.
Yeah, when we redo Ocean Boulevard.
I like the way you phrased that, yeah.
Let me see. Under Underwood Bridge. That's another thing that I've been working on. And you may know that that was a red-listed bridge at one point, and they did some repair on it, and then they did all of that they absolutely had to do and said we had like a 7-year window to come back with something. This past year, in the 10-year plan, I was able to get, they were going to finish it. They were going to finish repairing the bridge. And I said, don't spend that money. Don't spend that money. Take some of that money. I think it's $2.5 million. And they're going to do an engineering study to see what they might do about the evacuation. How they might widen the bridge and so forth. And that is part of the study for Ocean Boulevard as well. So that's that. As far as evacuation signs, I think evacuation signs would have to be a cooperative effort between NextEra and DOT. And
you're
I'm
right,
sure, I'm sure,
that,
I'm sure that NextEra would be footing the bill for that.
Good. They get a lot of money.
And so that's one thing. And the signage on 1A, I will check into that, because that was a byway study, right? That looked at 1A and 1B?
Yes.
Yeah. And I think that report just came out not too long ago.
So we're going to try to be friendly and attract everybody
to the
beach.
I will see what I can find out about that for you.
Yeah. Good.
Mr. Gein.
Thank you, Nancy.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Senator. Thank
Good
you
evening.
For everything that you do. Just strictly, no questions, just a re-emphasis on some of our efforts that Mr. Welch, the NHMA, and members of this board have struck with you in the last year. One is the NextEra issue that you just mentioned, that company. That's $1.2 million. That's the pollution control. We're interested in staying in that fight and be interested in hear what your efforts are. Going forward, and you don't need to answer it tonight because it's coming.
I'll tell you what I've been doing.
Okay, I've got a couple more. The transparency with the rooms and meals tax, I find it amazing that the New Hampshire State Senate cannot command a subordinate department to provide data that they deem necessary for them to fulfill their legislative agenda. Been listening to that for several years now. I'm just amazed in the United States of America, in this state, that the U.S. Senate that is elected cannot command a department head to provide data that they seem suitable to them. And then lastly is the, we'll just leave it there for now. Thank you.
Okay, so let's start at the bottom and work backwards. The transparency of the meals and rooms tax, maybe that can be part of that discussion that we go forward with the study committee, that we can push forward that, you know, anyone that has, any community that has more than a certain number, I mean 10, I don't care what the number is, then you should be able to find out what, how many businesses there are and what the contributions are and what the money returned is. I know they won't do it down to one. I know that. All right. I know you think that I can direct them to do it.
Yes.
And I do my best to direct them. But sometimes I'm not always successful. I know that I was stopped in the hallway the other day and said, Senator Stiles, everything in this place is about what Senator Stiles wants. And we're sick and tired of hearing this. I said, well, that's because I want all the right stuff, so what can I tell you? as far as NextEra goes, I have met with the chairman of the Energy Committee, Senate Energy Committee, and asked about putting an amendment onto one of their bills to see if there was an appropriate bill to do that, to bring it forward through the Senate. He said he would look at it, but he doubted very much that it would be I would be able to do that because of the vote that was in the House. It was 265-77 or something.
You mean on pollution control?
Yeah, on the pollution control. So then I went to the president, and I asked him if he would be able to include it in the budget in some fashion. And he gave me basically the same answer. Nancy, if the House defeated it, they're going to pull it out of the budget. So it's not going to be able to get into the budget and stay there. So chances are not. I will continue to work with both of those individuals and see what else I can do. But those are the two, the committee and the budget. And I figured if I went right to the top of the budget, that would be my best bet.
Thank you. And one last thing. You heard public comment tonight from Charles about a laboratory or rest station additionally at the State Beach. If you go to Rye, they have a very small state park. They've got an enormous with showers, a public facility. It is state-owned, state-operated.
Which one is that?
Odeorn. If you go to Northampton, they've got an infinitesimally small little state beach. They've got a brand new laboratory just completely done over. You go to North.
Welcome. I got that for them.
We love you, baby. Let's talk Hampton. And then and you come to Hampton, that infinitesimally small laboratory at Denham High Street that you work to not only get kept open in the winter with some local residents, but then you go down on that stretch and you've got to go clear down across the Ashworth so you find additional relief. We had a public hearing. We had two of those, and there were myriad vociferous complaints about people that had to attend to Mother Nature's calling, and they were aggrieved at their own residences. The state solicits those people to go to the beach. It's their beach. They take revenue from them, and they provide nothing for them. In the past, during the renovation at the state park, they had mobile stations for people to use the laboratory and implemented those. And I would suggest that in line of Charles's comments tonight and others, that that be put on the agenda and on the front burner and on simmer to alleviate the Hampton discomfort, if you will, from that lack of a station. Thank you.
I will try that again.
Thank you, ma'am.
And I would just like to say that I saw Senator Stiles earlier today. We were talking about the the drainage and how DOT was recently there, and they had a truck that first I had been to the bank, and we saw that it was coming headed south. So I was looking out the window when it went by, and it didn't even stop at the two drains where there's a house to the south of me. There are two drains in the road. And it just went by, and I thought, oh, my God, I can't believe they didn't stop. So I thought, I'm going to go out and ask them. And so that went down to the condos, and it did stop there. And the guys were doing something. There were two trucks and two men. And one was named Miles, and one was named Jeffrey. And they were from the Durham part of DOT. And so I said to him, I said, you know, I mentioned that I was a selectman here in Hampton, and I've been paying attention to the drainage, and that I have also lived there for 52 years, and that I was on the Seacoast Era Commission, and, you know, we've talked about these things, and I've met these different people. And I said, I was just wondering, why didn't you stop on these drains? This is where they need the most work. He said, well, those would be below water level or something. And I said, well, you know, I don't know, but, you know, I know that when there's a puddle there, it disappears within a half hour. Sometimes it could be an hour if it was something really major, but it does disappear. So they do work in some fashion. So, and then I didn't make a big deal of it. I went back to my business. And then, like, half hour later, I noticed the trucks pulling up again, and they go over there. So I went out again, and I talked to him. He says, well, we're going to try. And they evidently have these big pipes that are like 8 inches, and somehow they hook them to the truck. I don't know what it is, but it's some type of drain thing.
Vacuum.
a vacuum. Yeah, they were taking the stuff into the water. So they took the drains. The drain thing fell apart when they pulled it out, number one. You know, it just, all the pieces started falling off of it. But they did use that suction thing, and to their surprise, it made a big improvement. In fact, all the water started moving from all directions, so it all evidently drains there. But what they were kind of amazed is one drain comes from over, like, underneath the Century House. Yep. So it must be a drain that's a town drain that goes into there.
Don't know. Or a private drain.
Well, they said that there's definitely a drain draining into that. And again, I could see all that water. So I just want to reinforce, if you talked to anyone from DOT, Jeffrey and Miles were really nice. And they worked hard, and then the truck was full, and they said, we're going to come back. They came into my business. And then they came back and said, the truck's broke. So they said, we'll be back next week. But they did try, and I think there's some improvement. One thing is, I've just thought of this myself, although I don't know how it could possibly happen, but there is all this talk about needing another bathroom. I can tell you it's definitely a problem, because I get at least one a week, probably 50 a year, people wanting to use my bathroom, which you have to let them use it, because if you have a customer and you say no, it's like, oh my God, how could you be so mean? And so I always let them use it. They can tell I'm not happy. Sometimes they throw money at me when they leave, and I take it. But there's a property that's going to be for sale next to me that's right there on the marsh. It could be a beautiful piece of property for something like a way station of some type. Not only could they put a way station there, it's directly in the middle. And it's the only place I know that, I mean, other than that, there isn't anything open. But they could probably fix that drain and use that piece of property to go right through it. Like, they would like to go through Little Jackson and put all the drains through there. They could own that property, put the drain underneath it, and have a big, a nice bathroom that has a beautiful view of the marsh that's lovely. So, I don't know.
I'm just wondering if that bathroom is too close to the center and it's needed more so up at the end of Winnicott, as far as space goes.
It could be. It's an hour, it's a mile and a half from there, and it's a mile pretty much to the other end. Mm-hmm. But there isn't any land in between, and if they want to buy one of those houses that are up there, it's going to cost them about $600,000. That house can probably be had for a fraction of that. So I just thought I'd throw that out there. But thank you so much for coming tonight.
Okay, you're welcome.
And you always do a good job, and we're always happy to have you here.
I will get back to you on those issues that I said I would get back to you on, and thank you for being understanding and letting me come in late.
Thanks, all you do.
Thank you. Good to see you're looking healthy. Moving on to the Acting Chief Ayotte. And Captain Kennedy.
Thank you. I'm going to ask the deputy to pass out a couple of reports for you. Trust in Stephanie, sir. Trust in Stephanie. I do.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Hello. Good evening. Thank you very much for allowing us to come speak with you. As you know, Deputy Kennedy is with me again this evening. We'd like to stop and say thank you for allowing us this opportunity to bring forward Nate Denio as our new EMS officer. We appreciate you allowing his family to come in. This is an extremely big part of the process to allow the family to take part. We're a team at the fire department, and he's got his own team at home, and it's essential that we all work well together. So we certainly do appreciate that.
EMS Officer Denio has been serving in town of Hampton since 1998, as I indicated earlier. He's worked as a call firefighter for 3 years before being made a career or part of the career force. He became a paramedic in 2007 and has demonstrated great skill as a provider to the citizens and visitors of the town of Hampton. The position of EMS officer is a great responsibility. This position requires clinical excellence, management skills, and leadership ability that will influence all members of the department. Nate has successfully met the requirements for promotion to this position. In addition to scoring highest on the promotional exam, he's demonstrated a passion for EMS and conducts himself with the highest degree of professionalism. Nate's expressed goals for the organization and wants to raise the bar for our providers. I have also given Nate some of my own goals, which should keep him busy through about 2018. So, expect to see me again. Emergency medical services is a primary function here in Hampton. We service not only the residents for the town of Hampton, but also the people that drive through on their way to their final destination, whether that's north or south. And we provide medical care to those that come here and visit this resort community. During the summer months, we may see patients from all four corners of the globe. We get to hear a veritable cornucopia of foreign languages and even some really interesting variations of English. While we welcome Nate to this new role, we also recognize the departure of an old friend. EMS Officer Pete Wall retired on April 30th, 2015. We had a small ceremony at the fire station for his honor. Pete served the town of Hampton for 13 years, with four of those as the EMS officer. He has been a CPR and first aid instructor and has delivered classes to a great many people here in town. In total, he completed 21 years in public service in time here in Northampton as well as in Newington, and we wish him well in his retirement. You may be wondering just how important EMS in Hampton is. A quick review from the last time we met. 2014 was the busiest on record, as you recall, I told you that once before. For both fire and EMS calls, as of 4 p.m. today, we have had 56 more calls than last year, same time frame. 128 more calls than we did in 2013 for the same time frame. The calls continue to come in, and I feel confident as we come into the high season that we will watch these numbers continue to grow. On the fire side, we've had a total of 717 calls year to date, compared to 589 calls in 2014 in the same time frame. That's an increase of 128 calls over the last year. We have seen 16 fire calls with 3 structure fire calls and 2 other significant fires. It's spring in New England, and it's a wonderful day, as we all say. And with that, Deputy Kennedy has been providing continual leadership, and we've started our seasonal preventative maintenance on our apparatus. This is a time-consuming job that causes no small amount of effort in record-keeping and scheduling. Our fleet has been kept in great working order by keeping up with the maintenance. However, as you are well aware, we have an aging fleet. This year, Engine 4 will turn 28. This is currently the reserve engine, as Engine 2 is being repaired and maintained up north. This brings some exciting news, though. We have concluded the bid process for our new fire engine pumper. The voters endorsed this in March, and we certainly thank them for their support. The bid process closed Friday, May 1st, 2015, and we received 2 bids. I'll be notifying you about our examination of the proposals and also coming to you in the near future to open a discussion regarding the purchasing policy as it relates to our situation. Fire prevention. We continue to make progress in fire prevention. I cannot stress enough that we benefit from having the addition of Ms. Stephanie Welsh to our team. She has completed the checklists that I discussed at our last meeting, and they are being handed out to all of our customers as a hard copy when they apply for a permit. They are also being mailed along with a copy of an application to all of our businesses. We're doing so a month in advance, and then they return all of their reports to us. They'll be placed on the website this week so that customers can access them from home or at the office. The reports that you have in front of you, we call it a flowchart. It's actually a productivity report, and it lets you see our throughput. So on that document, in each one you have, there are several, and they're listed at the top. Stephanie's been kind enough to highlight for you. Permits of assembly, propane, oil burner, sprinklers, fire alarm. Anytime we're doing some sort of a permitting process, we're now documenting it. The reason that we're doing it in such a fashion is so that when we go forward right now, we're able to get a visual clue as to what work we have ahead of us and what work we have completed. On that document, you see open and completed, and then you also see comments. Mm-hmm. There's also a date when we received reports. There's a date when we acted upon them, and there's also another date when we closed the report. There's a little notation in there for all of the open projects that she maintains current. And what we're doing is we're following up with phone calls. If there's businesses, and there have been, through some of our mailings, we've seen that businesses have changed hands, as they're bound to do. And so we have return mail. Well, when that happens, we're updating our site files as well, and we're getting in contact with the new business. If some businesses take a long time to get back to us, we're sending a second notice. And then additionally, we're also sending a second letter and following up with phone calls. We've had great success, and we continue to do so. These reports are an excellent visual representation of the work that we're accomplishing right now, and it gives us a real handle on the situation as it stands for what's outstanding. Do you have any questions about the reports while we're talking about them? Not so much.
Anyone?
No, I think they're pretty good.
Mrs. Wellesley?
Great. Are we going to get a walk-in medical report from EMS Officer Denio when he gets himself situated?
I would love to give Nate another goal.
Because that does indicate the extra activity on the part of the department. I love the reports.
Yes,
that
ma'am.
Is great.
Just a note on that for the walk-in medicals. So that you understand, if they're treated, they have to sign a report, whether it's a refusal of care and treatment and transport.
Yep.
If we give them a Band-Aid, then they sign their name at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
If we treat or transport them, then they're included in the call list that, you know, as far as treated and transport for calls for the volume. So you are actually seeing a representation of how many calls we do have, whether they're being transported or not.
Okay.
That's not always to tell you, okay, well, 17 of them came into 119 Brown Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
Here and there, I can certainly get that information.
I'm just thinking in terms of you tying up personnel time when somebody's coming in for treatment.
Sure.
And sometimes if you're sufficiently shorthanded, you can't leave the poor guy sitting there, and that may mean that you have a problem with the response in the ambulance or on the engine.
Yep, well, we'll do call in just as any other ambulance call. We'll certainly call
in. I'm just trying to think of that.
Yep.
I had one other
thing.
Oh. Well, I don't know if this is relevant here, but I'll ask. Yeah, interact at all with the state health inspector. You're looking at conditions in the businesses and a lot of the restaurants and whatever, I'm guessing, and you're doing the inspection. Any coordination between health
inspectors? Not typically with our office.
Okay.
That's usually in the building.
Just the building inspector.
Yeah, well, Kevin's also the health inspector of the town.
Okay, okay.
And obviously I have a very good rapport with Kevin, and we've been discussing things back and forth. But typically on the health side, I leave that up to him. We've got enough to do with fire.
Okay. Thank you very much. Excellent report.
The FBO has been out on medical leave for some time, and Deputy Kennedy and I are filling the role. We're performing all the inspections, and Bill is doing the lion's share of that. I'm reviewing plans with the assistance of two really great supporters, and I can't thank them enough. Kevin Schultz has been right there by my side as the town building inspector, and Jason Bashan from the town planner's office, the new town planner, doing a great job helping me out, making sure that we get all things done accomplished in a timely manner. And as the summer season arrives, the seasonal businesses are coming online. They're looking for their inspections. In fact, he doesn't know it yet, but Bill has a jam-packed day tomorrow. Ms. Welch delights in filling our schedules with things to do, and you have five inspections tomorrow.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you, sir. May I have another?
You're welcome. Budget process. We're beginning this week. I'm going to notify the captains and lieutenants that have collateral duties that have a budget to submit their budget within the next 7 to 10 days. We're going to review that. We have to begin assembling. As Mr. Walsh will attest, he's going to call me in early July, I imagine, and say, I need to talk to you. So in doing so, we're going to have the collateral duties aligned before we begin the full-on budget process. But we anticipate that that's going to take some time. So we're going to be working towards completing that in advance of the summer. We continue to have many members recovering from long-term injury, and we wish them a speedy recovery. Their absence is certainly felt as other members work to fill their shifts. But I got to tell you, I'm very proud of the men and women at Hampton Fire Rescue as they continue to perform their best and most professional service around.
Good.
Okay. With that, I'm done. I've concluded my report, but I'll take any questions.
Yeah.
Thank you again.
Mr. Bridle.
Can I get a couple questions
for
you? Sure. You know, we hear about regionalization and stuff. Can you explain to me a little bit on how mutual aid works and why it's so important?
Sure. Currently, we're a really great fire department. We always want to be better. We wish and want for many things. But there's certain things that we just can't do. I would love to have, you know, the compliment of Fidney walking around with 6 people on a ladder truck and 5 on an engine. It would be wonderful. But it's not going to happen. So what we do instead is we use mutual aid, and we bring in resources from other communities quickly. If we have a house fire, knock wood, if we do, we have our two responding engines and our ladder truck. But immediately we need extra help. Mm-hmm. This has been proven. 68 Lock Road proved that day. It was five below zero that day. We were really cold. We had crews working all throughout, so it became very tedious. These guys went through two bottles real quick, and they needed help. So we had mutual aid. We had Northampton. We had Rise Air Trailer. We had Seabrook. We had Hampton Falls. I believe Exeter was there.
Portsmouth
was there. Amesbury was here. We had a lot of people showing up. This is an agreement between fire departments that if they're having an event, an emergency, and they need assistance, we'll go provide it. We have toys, if you want to call them. The firemen like their toys, right? We have a ladder truck. That's a toy to us. To everybody else, it's certainly a giant tool, right? And it's a rolling toolbox. Well, there are some communities that don't have a ladder truck. So we'll bring that to bear when they need it. If we have a fire on the west side of 95, that's a non-hydrant district for us. So we need water. We don't have a tanker truck. So we call on our neighbors with tanker trucks, Hampton Falls being one of our first. When they come back, this is a shared resource. We didn't buy the tanker truck, but we're using it. They didn't buy our ladder truck, but we're using it. As far as regionalization is concerned, we're doing a mutual aid process. We're sharing resources. But regionalization really talks about governing the fire department and how we see that. I think that firemen are firemen are firemen. If you show me three people standing around, two with a Maltese cross and one with a handlebar mustache, we're going to get stuff done. You know, that's just the way we are. If we're working under a different auspice, they don't care. They're going to go to work, and they're going to do a great job. When it comes to who's the boss and where's the money coming from and things like that, that's a lot outside of their purview. And I think that that discussion doesn't happen necessarily at fire departments. That happens beyond that. That's government. And a lot of people don't appreciate the fact that, you know, if you do a mutual aid system, you have your fire department, we have ours. If you need help, we'll provide it. And likewise, when we need help, you provide it. If we did a regionalization, then we would need to divide up the resources through the communities, and there would have to be a leveling to some degree because each community has different toys, right? So we need a lot. As a town, we need a lot. If you look down at the beach, and we've discussed it a little bit, we have a lot of building going on right now. And I think somebody said, and I think it was Senator Stiles, that mentioned 353 businesses that have the potential for room and meals tax. That's a lot of businesses. If you look to Hampton Falls, they certainly don't have that many. Well, should they share the same burden of cost? That is not for the fire departments to decide. You know, so as far as regionalization, that's a huge argument or discussion that needs to happen, I think, beyond the fire departments and the service. And, you know, it's funny because a lot of this stemmed out during the Budget Committee meetings and Board of Selectmen meetings where we were talking about the new fire engine. Regionalize. Well, the fact is, even if we were regional, if we were under the Seacoast Fire Department badge, it wouldn't matter. We would still need a fire engine down at the beach. We would still need a ladder truck here in town. We would still need three ambulances because we're putting them to work. So regardless of who is the overall authority, we still have the work, and we would still need the resources here. I hope that answered your question.
It did a little bit, because I would see it as if we had some sort of regionalization, that we'd lose local control.
Certainly.
And that would be a tough part. Right now, we decide what we feel is important. If you went to a regionalization, if it's a county that does it, then the county's going to decide what they want, and they're going to tell the town, well, this is what you need to pay. You've got no say over it.
That's true.
And that would be a tough part. I think with us having it as our own fire department, with the mutual aid system, which you guys do a good job at that, I think that gives it a much better preamble to how we run our department. You know, we've had some talk about part-time people. And back when I started, we did have a call force.
Long time ago, Mr.
Long time ago. It was a long time ago. But the department has changed.
It has.
We used to do a lot of fires and a few ambulance calls. And the call force was basically to assist the fire calls. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen anymore. We have very few fire calls, and we have a lot of, well, not a very few, but major incidents. We've gotten better at fire prevention and stuff, so we don't do that. But the problem is the ambulance calls, and they're highly skilled, highly trained, and you don't plan them. They don't happen. We haven't got one scheduled for tomorrow at 10 o'clock. You might well have one, two, or even three going on at once.
Yeah.
But you can't plan them. And that's what... And the cost to have somebody, a part-time person that's a nationally registered EMT, I, or paramedic, which is what we're going to, which the town has warranted and
certainly benefited from.
You know, the cost would be very much prohibitive, and I'm
sure
you'd
agree. And, you know, we actually have a gentleman, Firefighter Morrison, who's graduating this month from paramedic school. Paramedic school, when I attended in 97, was 12 months. It was 26 weeks of classroom, 1 week off, 26 weeks of clinical. And that was a long time. That was 40 hours a week. It was full time. It was a long time. It's 16 months now. There's so much information to be delivered that it's taking longer to do so. One of the big problems, and if you saw the article, I believe it was Norwell, Massachusetts, was discussing the situation. They're having a hard time filling the role of paramedic because so many paramedics get into the job and then move on to something else. It's very enticing to go to PA school or to to nursing school where you can see a larger salary. Paramedics aren't the best paid in the medical world. It's a very rewarding job, but it takes its toll. You know, lots of late nights and weekends and things like that. And you could definitely do better in a different field. So people are moving on from that quickly. It's cost prohibitive to send people to school to be a paramedic. Because last check, I believe it was $14,000 to send, almost $16,000 to send one through paramedic school. It's not cheap.
And I noticed, I read the paper last week on Stratum's problem they have over there, where they try to run their system with volunteers, and it isn't happening, and they're getting harder and harder and harder, and they're relying more and more and more on their communities around them.
Certainly.
So it is a tough field to try to get volunteers or even part on call.
Sure, absolutely.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yep. I'm sure you probably heard about, there was a gentleman here, Mr. Stone, asked at the hearing that we were having about not having a ambulance at the beach. Now, I know in the past that you've had one there in the summer. Do you have plans to do that again this year?
Not at our current staffing. What we have right now, we have three people at the beach, and that is currently where our paramedic is located during the day. If we have two, then the other one is usually at Winneconnet headquarters. But the idea behind it is that we're still providing medical care. When the engine responds as a first response unit, it has all of the ALS equipment on it necessary to perform all of the functions that they would have without the ambulance. The only thing they're lacking is the transport ability. Currently, where we're located right now with our ambulances, we have three ambulances located at headquarters. And the first ambulance will go out with the two people who signed for the day. Second ambulance, we're filling with callback or two other people filled for the day. If we were to do that right now with our current staffing level, if we were to put an ambulance down at the beach and that ambulance went out, potentially we would be leaving that engine unstaffed, and it's just not a safe situation to do so. We're providing that care. That care is getting there as quick as possible. The transport is coming within 60 seconds. And I feel very comfortable telling you that that's more than enough.
So are you suggesting that the call time is less than 7 minutes?
To the beach? Oh, significantly less.
So if somebody at the beach needed an ambulance, it would be in less than 7 minutes?
They would have medical care within, I believe, we're 2 minutes to most of the beach. Yeah, as we get further up, Ocean Boulevard up towards North Beach, I can see, especially during traffic, that would take a longer time. But to the beach proper, if we can call it that, from Ashcore on down, if we look at that area, we're there in less than 2 minutes, and almost every single address down there.
Okay, great.
Sure.
Glad to hear that. Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, thanks for coming in, guys. Thanks for everything you're doing. I love to see the support the fire department gives each other. The other guys coming in for the swearing in was great. This report, super. You're right on top of it. I hear much less people complaining,
fantastic,
which is always great, I think. And you're coming into your busy season?
We are.
You feel good?
We do.
Okay.
Yep, we're going to be busy.
Yeah.
You know? So if you see us out there and we're not stopping to say hello for 15 or 20 minutes, it's because we're on our way to the next inspection. He's got five tomorrow. So, you know, it's certainly going to be busy. But, yeah, we're right on top of it.
You guys do a great job.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Bean?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you. Chief, Deputy Chief, thank you very much for your leadership in the town and your additional duties that you're assuming.
You inspire confidence. You look pretty darn sharp in your uniforms tonight. Never seen you looking like that. You look great. Really do. Your men inspire confidence as they came in and mustered to support Mr. Denio. Congratulations to him. Stephanie Welch is inspiring confidence in the community with her efforts. So
certainly.
You've really cracked the nut on an issue that was causing some friction, and you're leading us out of that hole, and you're doing it in a very, very nice way, and people are talking about it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other questions, Mrs. Woolsey?
A couple of quick things.
Yes, ma'am.
Chief. How many men do you have out now on our staff on disability or workers' comp or
various forms? I think we're up to six.
Amanda just said six, I think, the last time.
Six.
You think it's still six?
Yep.
Ugh.
We have some long-term stuff going on.
Oh,
let's
I know
face
you
it.
Do.
You know, these guys are healing from surgeries and things. So.
I know you
and
do.
Women. We also had one of our dispatchers had a shoulder surgery. She recovered very well. She's still feeling it, but she returned to work within 2 weeks. Her job's a lot different than firefighting, but.
Yeah, that's good, because that's a concern, too, with the, with, I still say we're short-staffed. In conjunction with that, the ISO, well, you know, I have a copy of the letter from April 27th on the ISO individuals, and I see you're providing the information and so forth to them. Do you think the staffing will be a factor? We're looking good with machinery. We're looking good with everything set up in the department. Do you think the staffing level is going to be a problem? And I think we've just got, what, another year or so? 2008 was the last ISO rating. So we're coming up close.
I believe that Chief Silver went through some documentation with them in August of 2014. The letter that I received, and I think it's the same one, we're at 3.3x. Which I believe is the same place that we were at last year. I could be wrong. So, so we're remaining right where we are.
Good.
As far as the staffing issue, we don't have a staffing issue right now.
Yeah.
I would love to get my people healthy.
Yeah.
That is primary concern.
Right.
I need them to come back. In the future, I would love to have that discussion about adding staff. But more importantly, I need to just have my maintenance of minimums. So 9 is where we would like to be.
Right.
If somebody's out sick, we don't fill that shift. If somebody's on vacation, whatever it might be, we go down to 8.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see 9. That's a big push from my end. And as far as Stephanie goes, sir, we're going to see if we can't make her full-time. I'd like to add that as a full-time position. She certainly warrants it. She's doing great work, and the job warrants it. Like I told you before, I'm not going to build the organization on one person. We're going to build it on a framework. Whoever's in that job needs to be there full-time. I need a window. I need a face for business owners to come in and say, hey, I need a permit. Yep, there's your window right there. Go and see the face.
I thought you were going to say you wanted to clone her.
I would love to. It would be great.
But in the ISO,
no,
which is a concern to everybody with insurance, you're fine on the water supply, and you're fine on the machinery, the vehicles. So I'm just a little worried about the staffing. Now, the hose,
yes,
and
ma'am.
You and I discussed this briefly. I had left you a message because NECN had some kind of scary reports on defective fire hose. So I just said, please tell me that it's not our brand that we're using.
Well, you know, almost nothing in this world is fireproof. It's fire retardant. The article that you're referencing, they were specifically talking about fire hose burn through, and they were talking about it, and it's strange. I think that the wording that they had was spectacular. They haven't identified a solution to the problem yet. They've only identified the problem for the first time. Now, Worcester is granted by the, you know, by Providence that they are located with 13 learning institutions, whether it's colleges or universities.
Yes.
And they've kind of given all of their stuff, Worcester Fire, through, you know, their conjoined efforts. Worcester Fire had stuff, and they said, here, why don't you take it to WPI? These guys are, they're producing some of the top engineers in the field, certainly the largest resource scientists. So they're the ones who are looking at it. I can tell you, though, as far as it goes, all fire hoses are going to burn eventually. It's just, that's the way it is right now. We would like to make it better. The technology is not there. When it comes to there, you know, that'll be great. There'll be a cost issue associated with it. I have another problem that I would like to hopefully stem off with the purchase of a new truck. We're going to have to buy new equipment with it. Not the least of which is hose. Some of the hose, we're still testing it. May is testing, as you might recall. We're going to about start hose testing again. Hose testing is very important. If the hose tests and holds, we'll put it back in service. If it tests and fails, it goes away. All well and good, but some of our hose that we've tested and we still have in service today is 30 years old.
Yeah.
So it's still testing, but Lieutenant Gannon, who does a significant amount of fire-based research, mm-hmm. he did some testing, just, you know, off-the-cuff testing. What about this brand-new hose versus this older hose? And the flow rates, the friction loss was tremendously different, noticeable.
So it may have tested and held, but it's certainly not as capable as an inch-free quarter that was bought last year. With a new engine, I would like to outfit it with new hose. The warrant article we put forth was to get a new engine. Yeah. So some of this equipment we're going to have to, you know, we're going to have to work with. But I intend to do so.
Good. It just, I thought it was worrisome when I saw those articles.
Certainly.
And I did what any sensible person would do. I called you. There. But thank you guys so much. We're so proud of the department and great job.
I would just like to say that there has been a big, it's been quite noticeable about people talking about how much easier it is dealing at the fire department. And particularly Mr. Mike Welcome from Little Jack's.
Sure.
He was very impressed with especially your new girl.
Yep.
And Mr. Kennedy. So
wonderful. Glad to hear it.
He thought it was a big difference from previous years.
Great.
So thank you very much for coming this evening.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a great night.
Good one.
Okay.
Mr. Tinker?
Good evening, Ann. Okay.
This evening I have four items that I would like to go over with the board for your approval. The first is we've completed the first half tax warrant for 2015. That warrant is in the amount of $25,487,660.
Wow.
If anyone has any questions, regarding that number or anything to do with that number, I can answer those. Or if you'd like to, you know, approve the number.
Do you want to just go through all of your stuff, or should we ask individually?
However you want to do, it's fine. That is one.
Okay, we'll start with Rusty.
I'm all set. That's good. Thanks.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Yeah, just to clarify, Ed, for us. Basically, this is the first half of 2015, so I'm guessing that the 25 million means that we're going to be looking for 51 million total for the year.
At a minimum, of course, the second half would be based on a new tax rate.
But that's what I'm saying. But then right. This is the second portion of the end of 2014
right.
tax rate. Mm-hmm. So any changes we see won't happen until the December billing?
Right, that would be the final of, okay. of 2015.
So we're talking about over $50 million going through the tax collector's office
yep.
this year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, thank you very much.
Mr. Bean?
I have no questions. Thank
Mr. Wardell? Okay, you can move on.
Okay. Second item, I have two report of cuts which have tax warrants assigned to them, one of them being 95 Drakeside Road. And that's in the amount of, you hang on 1 second, I believe it's 20, it's a small one, $21. Mm-hmm. The second one is the 478 Exeter Road, which was a larger cut, a larger project. That warrant amount is $2,647.78.
Any questions?
So do we need a motion to it? Do we need a motion, or that's just?
Motion to sign?
You can need
wait.
A motion.
Yeah,
motion
wait. Do those. We do all of them?
Yeah.
I'll second Rusty okay. if you do.
You
want to? Well, he said we should wait till he does the rest of them.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fine. No questions, then.
All right. Third, I have a barn preservation easement. This is a barn that originally went into the preservation easement in 2004. There was a delay in getting the new one, but it is beginning in 2015. It's the Wayside Farm property. It was the original barn that went with the farm. There's no additional tax impact with this. It's just a renewal of the 10-year barn easement. Okay. Last, I have four abatements, all proposed refunds. Total amount of refund for the four is $1,574.67. Just one comment. Is I have six abatements remaining for 2015 or 2014 actually. Those will be presented no later than the end of June, of course. I'm going to try to get those to you within the next few weeks. It was a smaller number than usual because we are leading up into the reval, and typically they get fewer until we get to that point. So these four have been recommended for refunds in that amount.
Any questions before we make this motion? No?
Six,
do you have any question?
Six is music to our ears after all the writer's cramps.
No questions.
Exactly.
No question. I'll okay. Second Rusty if he's...
I'll make a motion that we sign these four items that he has here and move forward with them.
And Mrs. Wolseley seconded.
Yes, I seconded. Yep.
All in favor? Unanimous. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
I do have one last item.
Okay.
I'd just like to give the board some information. We have employed a contract assessor who today began working in the field. Jared Hines from CNHA Services started today. So he will be out in the field if you hear anyone asking questions or having any concerns with that. It should be a benefit having the additional person in the field to do some measuring, listing of properties that we believe have not been visited in many years. So we're looking forward to that leading up to the revaluation. It will help in that job being done at a higher level of approval based on more accurate information.
So you're very busy with the reval.
Yes, the reval has officially begun for us, me especially.
You're seeing a lot of activity in your office.
Yeah, Vision, we're finalizing the contract. Vision, of course, they won't have field people. We have our own field people now with the contractor. Data is being looked at as we speak, preparing to analyze the sales. Charlene in our office has begun visiting the sales that have not been visited to date. We're visiting sales back to April 1 of 2014, so we'll have 2 years' worth of sales data to develop our analysis, to develop our base rates and our adjustments accordingly.
Okay. Thank you very much, and have a nice evening.
Do we
Thank
have
you.
Any paperwork to sign?
Or
do you want us to?
It's circulating.
It's coming around. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate it.
Appreciate it.
Moving on to the town manager's report. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. At the request of the Board of Cemetery Commissioners, the tree removal contract for the Pine Grove Cemetery has been canceled. They indicated they'd be back to us with further information and desires.
Good.
Those concerned about the condition of the town's North Shore seawall located at the end of the state seawall, the replacement has been scheduled in the capital improvements plan for 2016. And based upon a prior engineering evaluation and preliminary report, the cost was estimated upwards of $500,000. I talked to the Public Works Director last Friday, and he's saying that that's closer to $1 million to replace the wall.
So we
obviously will have some outside engineering expertise put to work on that as time goes along and have some hard figures to give you. The state has set their base valuation for the town at $3.029 billion. The state has also estimated the population of Hampton at 15,120 citizens. Using the 2003 U.S. Census.
2013,
yes. I wish it was 2003 because I'd be a little younger at this point. They did that using that census. That's a change of 9,741 permanent residents since 1960. And I was a little surprised to see that Hampton is the eighth most densely populated municipality in the state of New Hampshire, which was a little surprise for me. I didn't expect it to be quite that high, but that's the way it is, according to the state's official figures. Mr. Chairman, in addition to those items, I've scheduled a public hearing for Monday, May 18th, 2015. This was your request a while ago to address the items that need to be addressed for seawalls along the ocean. So we'll schedule that up, and we'll be providing you with probably tons of information in the next week, so you'll be able to work at that diligently. Aquarian Water Company today sent us notice, and I want people to understand that this is something that they're doing this year. They are going to be replacing the water mains on Ross Avenue, King's Highway, part of it, 11th, 13th, 14th, and 15th Streets. So the folks up there should be receiving notices from Aquarian with regards to that upcoming work that's going to be brought forward. And as part of our ongoing evaluation and inventory of town property, we have done a complete inventory of the wastewater treatment plant. And in addition to the buildings and the vehicles and those sorts of things, I want to just tell you that we have $7,672,927 worth of materials, whether they be pumps or clarifiers or compressors or just about everything it takes to run a wastewater treatment plant. That is property of the town, and that's going into our inventory. It's also going into our insurance requirements for next year. And that's it, Mr. Chairman.
Questions, Mr. Bridle?
Nope, I'm all set, thank you.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Mr. Welch, as I was driving up Route 1, I noticed some great crosswalk signs that looked new to me. I don't remember seeing them there before. Town or state?
Town.
Nice, because even with the crosswalk painted, they're kind of a limey yellowy, but they stand out. And instead of relying just on the crosswalk painted across, very nice. They really get you. I was driving, I said, wow, where'd those come from? But that's
the
good.
The state will not allow those on state highways. They have the flip-flop signs that go in the middle of the road. It lasts about a week.
I love that on Route 1. That really stands out. I'm pretty excited.
The new signs are very reflective. There's a new reflective requirement under the federal regulations for the reflectivity.
They must have just gone in, but boy, that looks terrific. I was pretty excited. It doesn't take much to get me excited. Ecomaine, starting July 1st. Mm-hmm. Harking back to our conversations of, say, last year or so, are we going to arrange with Ecomaine a roll-off for furniture, which should save us money, in maybe a little, because they burn the furniture because they have the self-contained system up there. That way we get the big couches and tables and stuff and whatever out of our regular waste loads.
All of that material, we're going to be working towards that. The contract obviously is still running through legal.
Right.
They also take Christmas trees, and they also take leaves.
Ooh.
So there may be additional materials that can go in that we won't have to spend considerable money on processing and shipping and revolving with heavy equipment and so forth. We're looking into all of that, and we'll see what the weight factors are, because we don't really want to put a large bump in that curve as far as weight is concerned.
But instead, I mean, you have the screws or whatever you call them at the transfer station, and there's wear and tear on that when you're squashing those great big couches and stuff in there.
Yeah.
So I just thinking about
the roll-off is something we're working on. We've been working on that for a while because we want to be able to get rid of that stuffed furniture, the bulky waste, as we call it, and not have to pay to have that dumped in a landfill.
Because all that was being buried up in Rochester until...
Yes.
Yes. So I'm thinking. Thank you. That's it.
Thank you, ma'am.
Mr. Bean?
No, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, sir.
And Mr. Wardell?
Yes, just point of clarification. During public comment, somebody talked about Exeter Road. That's just temporary, right? What's being done now?
The paving that we're doing now on Exeter Road is a temporary patch.
And then
We're going to grind down portions of the road to make it uniform, so it'll be easier to apply, and water will actually crown off the road instead of running in all kinds of different directions and causing problems, as it does now. We will then put down a base course of material, and then we'll put down a finished course of material. And as a matter of fact, the bid documents in your agenda tonight to do that particular work. Mm-hmm. We expect that to be done, because contracts being awarded now, in about 30 days we expect the start of that. And that'll go along with the other three or four streets up off of Route 1 that are right near Exeter Road as well.
Yeah, I think some people had the confusion that what was being done right, you know, the filling the pothole was the work.
No.
No.
Yeah. Right.
Correct.
Yeah.
I'm happy to say it is not the work, and it will be a professional paving job, although it'll be temporary. When I say temporary, a paving job on a road like that is going to last for probably 10 years until the road, something is done with the construction of the road. And we're looking at options as opposed to spending $5.8 million in tearing the whole road up and rebuilding it. There are other options available. And as far as the sewer line is concerned, we are looking at a number of different options as well as lining the existing sewer. Some of it has to be replaced because it's already crushed in some areas. Yeah. Not fully crushed, but it is crushed in somewhat. Those will have to be excavated and fixed. We also have to do the drainage facilities and the catch basins. So it's all coming together, and hopefully we can chop off a lot of that money and get this done expeditiously.
Very good.
And, you know, one thing that is good is that there's a movement for a master plan going on for the Montrone land down there. And, you know, maybe by the time it's time to do the real job on Exeter Road, there'll be a lot more resources that can go into it in one way or another, especially according to how they rezone it or however it's reclassified.
Right.
So this is a really good time. And did you have another question?
Well, Fred actually expanded on what I was going to say, but be careful what you wish for, because with the restructuring and reconfiguring of that area, what people have been asking for and yet dreading on the west side of town is a sewer service going over there, which is going to mean even worse building. So it's
not necessarily.
Well, mixed blessing.
Everything is.
And thank you for your report, Mr. Walsh.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, moving on to new business. The Hampton Beach Village District Municipal Parking Lot. Did you want to open that, Mr. Welch?
Mr. Chairman, the board had received a letter from the council for the precinct. Mm-hmm. Under state law, both the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board have the right under 674-54 with proper notice to have a hearing to explore the proposed municipal parking at the beach. And my suggestion to the board is that that probably more properly belongs in the bailiwick of the Planning Board as opposed to the Board of Selectmen. They do parking. They have zoning ordinances and regulations that govern parking. This is a sort of a complementary look at what's there. There's very little the town can do with regards to what they're going to build. It has to comply with normal state regulations and town regulations, but this advisory hearing, I will call it, because that's what it is for another governmental body. They purchased the land, and my recommendation to the Board of Selectmen is to allow the Planning Board to hold this hearing if they so desire.
And so do we need to make a motion for that?
No, you only need to make a motion if you want to hold the hearing.
Okay.
So. Well, then, and Jim, that's you, the Planning Board, so you'll take that back to them. I did talk to Chuck Rage today. He happened to call me, and none of them could be here. They would gladly come if there was any reason that we needed to have them in the future. No one was available. Otherwise, they would have been.
It happens.
Okay, so you'll take care of that. Next, we have two different donations: a $500 donation to the fire department, and a $500 donation to the Department of Public Works. And we need to accept that. Can we accept them together?
You certainly can, sir.
I'll make the motion that we accept these donations, and with a thank you to the person that gave them to these two departments. They gave them for the excellent work that was done this winter during our snowstorms. Both departments were used, and we really appreciate that. And I think we send a thank you letter to this person for that. So,
I'll second Mr. Waddell seconded.
I have a real quick question on that. Just the donor said that they wish the check to be used, the money to be used to buy equipment or whatever. Can we do that, since this is a donation coming from outside, or are we constrained by the budget?
You can. It's legally on the agenda. It's less than $10,000, so it needs to have a spot on the agenda. By accepting these, you're accepting them with the condition that they be used for the purpose for which they were donated.
Perfect.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. And next, we have a waiver from purchasing policy section 718-4B, period B, parentheses 1, and 718-4, period B, parentheses 2.
Mr. Chairman, this relates to bids that were opened for the paving of Exeter Road, believe it or not, as well as bidding that encompassed the other three streets that are to be paved, namely
Fairfield, Ruth,
and Belmont. The low bidder for this particular project was GMI Asphalt of Belmont, New Hampshire. And the total bid price you have received, it is $105,377.45. We recommend that the board grant the waiver. We did, in putting the bids out, we did send bidding proposals to the major bidders, the major pavers in this area, Brock, Libby Scott, Pike Industries, and Continental Paving. All of them did not bid. The bidder here was GMI Asphalt, and we had a second bidder who was an awful low bidder. This is an exceptionally good price. They plan on doing this all at once, and they plan on doing it by mid-June. So we'll be away from the major summer rush. And that's just as well that we're away from the rush. We will have to probably close down one side of Exeter Road to get it paved, and then the other side of Exeter Road. Because they're going to go right straight through and pave the road. This is not going to be one of these things where you come in and drop the paving machine and pave for a couple of hours and go away for a day. They're going to do the whole thing in probably 2 days to get it done. So we'll be alternating traffic.
Now, is there, it seems like there is are many, well, there's certainly a lot of criticism about avoiding the town purchasing policy. Does the town purchasing policy need to be looked at? Do we need to have it say something different? I mean, I heard, well, here's one here. Then I heard there's a problem at the trustees of the cemeteries with the purchasing policy. And there seems to be constant criticism.
Well, you know, we try to provide, when we send these bids out, we try to send them to the companies, the larger companies that do this work. And we deliberately send them directly to the companies with a request that they bid. Some of them are not interested in doing work in Hampton.
I can understand with the reputation that
well,
we have.
Well, with regards to paving, I think we all need to understand that the town has not done any appreciable paving in the last 5 years. Okay? The result is that these companies, I'll pick a good one here, Pike Industries, they're concentrating all their efforts on the many millions of dollars worth of state paving that's currently contracted, and they're the contractor. And the other big three also have other major projects that they're doing. That money is well, it's a lot more money than we can put out there, and it gives them work for most of the year.
Yeah.
So they're not looking to work into the wintertime, and as a result, they did not bid on any of these programs. If we start a paving program, and that is the intention of the town, or at least the administration, so that we do X amount of paving per year, then we're going to start to see the big companies coming back, and we're going to start to see receiving three or more bids. Personally, I think three or more bids is a good goal. We try for that all the time. I don't see where we need to change the purchasing policy. What we need to do is we need to be consistent in what we do and how we do it, and we're trying to do that. We have extensive review of these bids before they go out, both from a legal standpoint and from a professional standpoint. We do call the companies and request that they bid. We're very thorough about that sort of thing. We have to have some standard. Otherwise, the taxpayers are not protected. And I don't see there's a magic to changing the number or lessening the bid requirements. In several cases over the last few years, we've actually increased the bidding requirements and the technical reasons behind it. And it's worked, I think, to the benefit of the town. But there are going to be times when we're just not going to be able to get three bids.
Some situations, many are unique.
They are unique in many cases. This one is a unique one because the big vendors are not doing small work.
Okay, questions? Mr. Bridle.
The question I have is I look at these prices, and I know what was the original estimate for the Warren article for Exeter Road was considerably more than that, and I understand that money would have to be spent on Exeter Road.
Right, that's correct.
But the other money that we got from the
grant,
the highway block grant, we obviously have a different savings there, so we could potentially see other roads in town being paved.
That is correct.
Out of that money, correct?
That is correct, and we are looking at a fall major paving program.
Okay.
We have a number of roads in town that are getting to the point, if we don't do something with them, getting to the point of Exeter Road. And as I explained to department heads a couple of weeks ago, I am not prepared to come to the taxpayers of this town and ask for $20 or $30 million to fix roads if we're just going to let them go. And that's going to be a drop in the bucket. So we need to start paving, and we need to do that every single year. We just can't be playing the game, and we need to put out somewhere between $500,000 and $1 million worth of paving a year if we're going to catch up.
So, all right, thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Wardell?
The bids come in considerably under. Right?
They did.
Okay. And only two companies bid?
Yes.
Okay. And we're sure that these are reputable, and we're sure that they're companies that can do the job. And
GMI is a reputable company. I've done business with them in various other parts of New Hampshire. We did check their references, obviously. We know them. The other vendor, they came in, and if we took the actual bid that they received, because they did it wrong, it would have been something like $4.5 million to do this work. They put the wrong figure in the wrong place, and unfortunately, that didn't work for them. So what we used was they had a written figure, and they had a lettered figure, and the lettered figure is the one we used for the estimate, which was $107,000 as opposed to $105,000.
And if we were to say we'll wait to try and get three bids, we would just delay the project, right, and it would get into...
It'll be fall.
Be fall. So to be expedient. To get it done, we really should look at this.
Yeah. Well, and it will save money in the long run to do it now, because obviously we're spending... We only have three highway employees on a regular day.
Right.
And we're sending all three of those highway employees up there on too many days to keep on patching potholes. So we need to get that done and out of the way. In the meantime, we'll be stopping all that hemorrhaging of pothole repairing and asphalt to do that we're just going to chew up.
Thank you.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Fred, I don't remember, and I didn't have time to look it up today. The block grant figure...
$264,000, I think it was.
Okay, because what I'm looking at here, and I was puzzled when I was reading Chris's material, it's talking about $1,020 to do the Tuckfield Loop Road, $38 and change for Fairfield, $11 and change for Ruth Lane, Belmont Circle, $15 and change, and the Exeter Road, $40,000. I'm just, $40,000? You know, one thing you said to me a couple of years ago, the grinding pile is going down at Public Works.
Yes.
Because you're right. A lot of that, it was a mountain a couple of years ago.
Yes.
But I'm just wondering, that seems like an awfully low.
They bid it.
I mean, if they can do it, but...
They're talking about being able to do that. Now, that will allow us to do additional work on Exeter Road.
Okay, because I'm also thinking, I'm very much opposed to promising the public that we're going to do 13 roads like we were doing a couple of years back,
no.
And you keep naming them again and again. But this certainly gives us the ability to do the loop road and the three roads that have to be done. So now we can go back to Director Jacobs and ask him, once we get through that, if we can do things like Mary Batchelder or whatever other roads.
Well, there's a 200 and I'm going to use 250,000. Nice
yeah,
round.
Yeah, I remember.
Tuckfield Loop Road, 1,020 was in the appropriation for the Recreation Department.
Oh, okay.
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 And that came out of their rec fund.
Good.
That road needed to be done. Fairfield, Ruth, and Belmont will come out of the appropriation from the Highway Block Grant.
Yeah, long
and
overdue.
Exeter Road will come from the special appropriation. So the total of all of them is $105,377. What we're going to be looking at after we get it all done is what can we now do in regard to the improvement of Exeter Road with the balance of funds that are left over.
Okay. Like, for instance, you mean drainage and...
Well, there's still additional paving to do. There are the sidewalks to fix. There's the ramps to the side roads to fix. There are all those different things, driveway ramps and so forth that need to be fixed.
Drainage is critical, right.
And road edges and stuff like that that's part of the paving. All those different things. And now it appears that we're going to have some funds to take care of some of those problems. Just keep our fingers crossed and everything runs fine. Okay.
Mr.
We'll be off and running.
Amazing.
Questions for the town manager?
I would commend your leadership and Superintendent Jacobs and his leadership team in going out and striking harder deals, harder bargains, and saving taxpayers money and really leaning forward. And I do see a battle rhythm with our leadership people in this town across all our departments. And I think it's noticeable to the entire community, and I think it manifests itself in sharpening the pencil and coming in with Plan B after some efforts last year that were much more expensive and really didn't hit the nail on the head. Thank you, Mr. Welch.
Thank you, sir.
Does someone want to make the motion about the purchasing policy?
I'll make the motion.
Mr. Waddell, second by Mr. Bridle. All those in favor? Unanimous. Old business, committee appointments.
Mr. Chairman, could we have one more thing? Well, this is probably old business. Ignore me.
Okay.
Well.
Okay. Under old business, committee appointments. Did you want to, which ones?
You have one committee left to consider, Mr. Chairman. That's the Education Recycling Committee.
Mr. Chairman, can I make a motion that, we saved this committee last year.
Mm-hmm.
We really have heard nothing from them in the year that we've been that. Mm-hmm. We now have a new EcoMaine mm-hmm. that we're going to be going to. I think this committee has done its job. I think it's time that we sunset this committee. And if there comes to a need to call it back, then we do so at that time. But at this time, I think we just thank the people that have been on that. They've done an excellent job. But it's time to move forward.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion?
Well,
if there's a second, we'll discuss it.
I'll second it.
Okay. For discussion, Mrs. Wolseley?
Right. Apparently, either the recycling committee was not notified or they didn't understand when we brought in we did our goals night, and we brought in energy and highway safety and all that. And either they missed it or something happened. I did talk to a couple of them. Mrs. Baker, who was here earlier tonight, is no longer going to have the time to work on the committee, but the remaining individuals do want to continue. I suggested to them that they might want to make an appointment to talk to us, just because they haven't been heard and their appointments have been pending. And I said that our concerns for all the committees are whether meetings are being posted properly, whether they're taking minutes and putting them on the internet. And basically we're looking for a memo at some point in time on the consistent operation of all the committees. So I think recycling kind of fell through the cracks, and it's the pleasure of the board, but
okay, if they could have a motion and a second. Any other discussion?
They might have missed that meeting, but have they been doing anything all year? Have we had correspondence from them all year? Has there been any, you know, do we know what's been going on all year? I mean, I was one of the ones that you know, said, let's save it last year.
Right.
But if nothing's going on, I don't know why.
They have been having some meetings. I have no minutes. There are none posted on the website. Mm-hmm. I asked the town clerk for minutes, and she said she had very few. Mm. This is since its creation, not just last year. I know they've been meeting because I see them meet. It's hard to miss when they're right next door to you, and you have to walk right by when they're having their meetings.
There's no longer department heads going.
No, my understanding is Public Works asked the department head not to go, so
yeah.
Because he had other duties to perform, and he didn't have enough time to finish them all. We're about to go into a brand new contract for solid waste, and those folks put out, they probably need to do more recycling because they put a lot of material in paper form about recycling. I would think that what would happen is that we get together with the people from EcoMaine and we talk about that subject. And if they feel they need to work with a committee from the town, then we can come back and revisit this if you want to,
yeah.
and reinstitute the committee. I purposely at the last meeting brought up this subject, mm-hmm. simply because I wanted everybody to know that this was going to be the night that you were going to consider it.
Mm-hmm.
So because I was concerned that everybody needed to know.
Right.
Okay. All those in favor? For? Against?
Well, I think this points out the fact that as boards of selectmen have gone along, they haven't really been consistent about setting a policy like we discussed, mm-hmm. as guidance to all of the selectmen committees. So I'm going to abstain on this one. Jim wanted to save it last year, and I was the one who wanted to sunset it.
Okay, thank you.
But
now
abstain.
The other committee that we didn't talk about last week, there needs to be a representative for that, Montrone. I guess it's for the zoning board. It's going to be a zoning committee.
Zoning study committee.
And they want to have a selectman's representative.
Yes, they do.
I would suggest it be the same person that's at the planning.
How about the alternative? The
or
alternate?
Possibly, if you want to do it that way.
Since the alternate doesn't have a committee.
What?
You don't have a number one? Okay, then maybe you might be a good point, because you are the alternate to the... You're the alternate to the budget committee.
And I'm the alternate to the planning board, too.
Oh.
So I have no problem.
He's talented.
Okay.
I have no problem taking
that. So do we have to make a motion on that?
If you wish to appoint, I would say so.
Yeah.
Make a motion that Selectman Breidel.
And a second? All those in favor? Unanimous.
I abstain. You just got your draft card removed.
I abstain.
Okay.
Sir.
So are there any other committee?
No, sir.
And Deputy Town Manager Sullivan is working on?
Yes, he is. Committee information so that we have a set policy and decision and a timeline on how to operate things and how to do things and put them online and so forth.
Okay, and about the 2015 Selectman goals, do we have a synopsis of that?
I believe that was sent to you in your packet.
Yes.
For this meeting.
I'd rather hold on that if we can.
That's fine.
Would you rather wait until next time?
Thank yeah, that's fine. I'd rather read it.
Fine. Another, yeah.
Meditate.
Yes.
No hurry.
And then under old business, I thought we would bring up about last week and the budget committee. I purposely did not bring it up last week to engage further because Mr. Breidel wasn't here. And I thought that we should go over what is the plan of the board, even though we've been doing it all last year and this year. So, Mr. Bean, I thought we'd ask you to open this up.
Well, sure. And last week it got a little tempestuous over this, and Selectman Woolsey talks about minutes and procedures with committees, and rightfully so. And as she stepped aside from the budget committee, it was my turn, and there was a request for a report by the selectman's representative, which is what I gave. I talked a little bit about the budget history last year. The remarks are on cable. We talked about essentially command and leadership selectmen provide. Talked about lines of communication, simplicity, unity of command, the economy of our resources. And essentially all of that really does lead to what Mr. Pierce is doing tonight and does divulge and expose full transparency. I spoke prior to that meeting with both the town manager in his office and Mr. Griffin at his business and discussed those exact lines of communication, whereas legal and assessing report to the Board of Selectmen, all of the departments report to Mr. Welch. There was agreement by both Mr. Welch and the town manager and Mr. Griffin. And it essentially is that the operational and administrative control over those departments lies with both Mr. Welch and Mr. Griffin and the board. Again, by instituting those information requests, both from the boards to the Board of Selectmen and to Mr. Welch, I think you can enhance the budget process. I think you can have a better budget process. There are some 50 people that are on these boards and committees here. We have 50 board and committee members calling different department heads at any one time, even during the week. Because our folks are so responsive, it does tend to tie things up. And I think when you have board members asking questions they were asking of the planning board, I think that Mr. Waddell would need to know, and it would go through him. It has been my implicit and explicit understanding that's how this board wished to function. So I say here again tonight with a full board, whatever the chairs and whatever the board's preference is, I'm happy to follow it. And I yield back to you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, and Mr. Welch, how is it that you understand that process about the employees going to the different committees?
I talked to the chairman of the budget committee about this. My understanding is that the chairman of the budget committee would ask the chairman of the board of selectmen. The selectmen would then consider it if that needed to be and would pass it down to those who were involved. It's a selectman function. The liaison between the chairman of the budget committee and the chairman of the board of selectmen is the liaison. And that would normally go through the selectman's selected liaison to that particular committee. So there would be that route going around that circle and coming back and forth each of you. And from that, there would be either dissemination to this board or there would be instruction from that group for individuals to do whatever was necessary to carry out the functions that were being talked about.
And so do you feel that it's more important for the employees to go like after the summer when the budget has started moving, or you've mentioned in the past about people having a certain amount of time there or whatever?
Well, right now is probably the worst time of the year for any of us to be going anywhere.
Gearing up for summer.
I do have to consider that. I know, for instance, Ed was just here a minute ago. He's in the middle of a reval. During the day, he's frequenting my office and tearing his hair out and trying to get help to do different things. The guy is just going crazy. I have the same problem. I've had public works in here 3 times today on different matters. And it goes to all the various departments, recreation and so, police, fire, everybody. They're very, very busy, and that won't slacken off until we actually get into the budget detail, which will be the budget message is going out next week. They'll start working on that whole spectrum of things between that and warrant articles between now and the time it goes to the Board of Selectmen, which will be sometime in the early or late summer, early fall. I'm keeping them at least the folks that report to me, very, very, very busy at the moment. And there are a number of occasions where I am being told where people are requesting things repeatedly, not necessarily from a particular board or committee, but taking time up away from what they should be doing for the entire town. That happens. We try to discourage that or try to get the things done quickly as possible. So I think a level of command on the select board is important so that you have some consistency on what's going on and you can control that, because I think that's the board's function. I just try to make sure my department heads get their work done, and that's difficult this time of the year.
And I'm not really sure, although I've watched all the budget committee meetings, but I'm not really clear on whether they're planning on meeting during the summer, but I know in the past they haven't.
I don't have a schedule.
Yeah, so I haven't heard if they're going to. But I have talked to some of the people on the budget committee, and they seem to be under the impression that there probably won't be that many meetings in the summer. And there are some people that are feel that the different parts of the committee that they're responsible to, for instance, the precinct, they don't really need to be there all the time. You know, and they're very busy during the summer. That's their big time. So
they don't have any meetings during the summer. So
at this time of the year, I'm really not clear how, you know, if it is so important, especially when everyone is busy. Questions, Mr. Waddell?
I just think that a line of command is important, and I think it's important that if we have representatives to the various committees, that the committees go through those representatives. And I think it's important that the department heads and the employees are doing their jobs that they're supposed to be doing for the town. And it becomes counterproductive if everybody, I mean, it becomes so counterproductive that I've heard my name thrown around, that I said this and I said that, and then I took it back, and
that,
what the heck are we talking about?
Me.
It was a surprise to me, too. I was really surprised, but that's all right. Doesn't bother me, but I mean, that's the kind of thing that happens when you start to go this way. If you have a chain of command, you have a representative, you have, if the Board of Selectmen are the employees, are the in charge of those employees, then it should come through the Board of Selectmen. And we had discussed that prior to that, that the representatives were going to do that. So I think that that's very important, and I agree 100% that it should be a line of command, that it should go that way.
And that's how we were operating last year.
Yeah.
Not just this year. Mr. Bridle?
Well, I totally agree. I think that that it makes a smoother operation if they come if we're responsible for those employees and they come through us. If the town manager is responsible, then they can still come through our representative that's on that board, whichever board it is. If the planning board has some information, then they should come through Jim. If it's the budget committee, then they should come through Phil. And I think that's I think it's going to be smoother, cleaner. We can get a lot more done, a lot more productive. You know, we're told all the time we got to do more with less. Well, our department heads are trying the best they can with more with less. And to put other information on them when they have other jobs that they need to get done, I think is counterproductive. So it should come through our selectmen's representatives that are on those boards, whichever committee it is.
So we do seem to have a consensus that this, I'm still going to let you speak, Mrs. Wolseley, but we do seem to have a consensus that this is the way it was done last year and this year. And so I just want to say that. And what would you like to say?
The way it was done last year was that Mr. Waddell was the representative. There were constant complaints about the Municipal Budget Committee. I don't remember Mr. Waddell coming to us for any one of the meetings related to who was appearing before the Municipal Budget Committee. I have been elected to the Municipal Budget Committee in the town of Hampton 7 times. I have served as chairman of the budget committee. I have served as select man representative to the budget committee. I have served as a regular member of the committee. What I will say to you is this. I asked this board to get together in public with the planning board. I have the memo from Mr. Welch talking about subjects that we need to discuss with the planning board. And in the minutes of April 13th, Selectman Waddell said, the planning board is an elected board voted on by the voters. They have specific things they're supposed to deal with, and they do. If we have questions, they should be given to me as a representative. I don't see one board telling another board what to do. I want you to think about this.
May I respond to this? You just quoted me.
Let her speak, yeah. And I want to respond to it, too, because I have part of this, because I've already done this last year. So we will let her say all she wants to say.
Thank you. That is very kind of you. The municipal budget law is RSA 32. There is no stipulation in that law that requires the chairman of the budget committee to go through anyone, and the chairman of the budget committee controls that committee with their consent. RSA 32:16 Roman 2 says that it doesn't tell the budget committee how to conduct business, but it says that their mission is to confer with the governing body or bodies and with other officers, department heads, and other officials relative to estimated costs, revenues anticipated, and services performed to the extent deemed necessary by the budget committee. It shall be the duty of all such officers and other persons to furnish such pertinent information to the budget committee. End quote. A representative to the budget committee from this board or the precinct commissioners or the school board is a conduit. The person is a gopher. You go to the meetings, you are a legitimate voting member of the budget committee. You participate, you answer questions from the members of the committee. If requested, you can bring in material to share, or you can take back requests to your board, which has happened in the past. I have never ever, in all the time I have been doing this, seen a chairman of the Municipal Budget Committee undercut by some members of the Board of Selectmen. The chairman of the Budget Committee has the authority to run that committee. I came to you after all the complaints and all the uproars last year, and the relationship with the Budget Committee needed to be mended a little bit. I think we agreed with that. I told all of you exactly what I had in mind. I told all of you that I was willing to take up, because I have experience, take up the burden of working with the Budget Committee, and in an effort to try to calm things down between the Budget Committee and the Board of Selectmen, I suggested to the chairman, and I told you that she might want to do a non-controversial meeting as a kickoff for the new year. Who is less controversial than the assessing officer? I said, with the reval coming up, and it is important, and it is only April, and the reval is just starting, she checked with him within a day or two of that meeting in March. She coordinated with him. If your new approach to working with the budget committee and any other, like the planning board, is to have the specific individual report to this board, fine, but none of us has any business interfering directly with the budget committee, specifically with the chairman of the budget committee. That is out of line, and that was done without my knowledge. I am the easiest person in this town to find. I have had the same phone number for 51 years. A crummy little message on my answering machine might suffice. But I will tell you that I think, A, what was done is illegal. I think it's illegal for some members of this committee, this board, to act without myself. And I can't speak for what Rusty might have known, but when I spoke with Ed Tinker last Thursday, I was told directly, I said, who told you this? Who pulled the assessing officer from the agenda the afternoon of the meeting.
Okay, point of order here, Mrs. Woolsey.
Point of order.
Point of order here. We are discussing what is the policy of this board. This is the policy, not
but
this year.
But the policy of this board can't conflict with the statute.
Mrs. Woolsey, am talking.
And you told me I have the time to talk now, and I'm going to.
Okay.
I'm going to talk and finish my comments here.
Okay.
We have no authority in any way, shape, or form to interfere with the Budget Committee. Interfere. To pull a guest speaker before the Budget Committee, and yes, he does work for the Board of Selectmen, to pull that person without the knowledge of the entire board and without contacting the chairman of the Budget Committee. I will tell you that I would pay money to hear the telephone conversation between a representative from this board and the chairman of the Budget Committee if she were called on Tuesday afternoon and told, we're not going to let the assessing officer go to your meeting tonight. You've wasted a whole meeting for the Budget Committee. You wasted the whole April meeting for the Budget Committee. And I will say that I say to you that it is illegal to do any of this. Whoever you want to report to who, it is illegal for you to do any of this behind my back. You could call a meeting. If you had called a meeting, Rusty was out of the state. If you had called a meeting, there are three of you and one of me. And if you wanted to try voting and saying we're going to pull the assessing officer, I would have been outvoted. But I say to you, and I would like Mr. I will say that we have counsel here, and I believe it is absolutely illegal, A, to do this behind my back, and B, to interfere with an individual who's booked on to speak to the Budget Committee. If you want to say in subsequent months, don't call the police chief, don't call the fire chief, or you can't have them till such and such a month, you can try it. But the language of the statute is crystal clear.
Okay, you've had your say, Mrs. Woolsey.
Crystal clear.
The thing is, obviously, you just don't understand because you don't realize we did this all last year.
No, you didn't do it all last year. When did
you
do this
last
year?
I'm sorry, Mrs. Woolsey, we did.
I sat
last year when I was the one that invited the planning board, they have no interest in coming here.
Well, that's fine, but we're not talking about the planning board.
No, you just mentioned about the planning board, and Mr. Waddell.
I said about interfering.
Mrs. Woolsey, you've had your time. Please, you are out of line again. Now, Mr. Waddell, would you like to speak?
Well, you know, we're just beating a dead horse here. We went through this all last week. We're going to go through it again. If somebody feels it's illegal, then they should do whatever they need to do. And that's all I have to say.
Okay, and now we will ask the lawyer, the town Esquire. Mrs. Woolsey, please.
Okay, the Budget Committee operates within a certain context. That context is developing a budget. But the way this town does it, as so many others do, is the manager develops a budget, it's passed to the selectmen, and then it goes to the Budget Committee. And so that's the way it's always been done and is proper. What the Budget Committee, and I've listened to their minutes as well, is proposing is to have a group of committees that will be roving throughout the departments in the town and thereby, whenever they deem they want to, come and have the department head be involved. That's no way to run a railroad. The Budget Committee is not the town, and it's not the town manager. Their approach, as it seems to me, is to try to essentially act in your role or the town manager's role. We have just gotten a budget in March, the budget we have to live with for the year, and the Budget Committee is already starting in with these committees, which is several years ago, they met during the summer, and we're in on this approach of getting into the weeds operationally with the departments, which is disturbing. We had department heads that last year spent hours in front of the Budget Committee. They voted our budgets. And then what they did in the last half hour of the last meeting was to undo it, and it appears that our entire time last year was wasted. Mm-hmm. That's not exactly answering a legal question, but I'm answering to you what the perception is, I believe, of the department heads who were put through this. And now the Budget Committee proposes to meet during the summer with these committees, come to the departments, and essentially, it looks like, interfere with operations. There needs to be a control. Yes, there are all these obligations under the right to know, under the Budget Committee law, to confer with the Budget Committee, to supply information to the Budget Committee, but there operationally has to be a way to do that in an appropriate manner. And that is what Mr. Bean communicated quite clearly to the Budget Committee. They may not like it, but that's operationally what the manager needs to do, and I think what this board needs to do in order to run the town. And that, I think there's an accommodation. There are not merely these unfettered obligations under the budget law. I believe also there's some consideration for operational matters. And this board, running two of the departments directly, my own and the assessor's, I think has a voice in how those departments interact and how we appear. Otherwise, we won't get our jobs done. And this manager is in charge of the departments. So I think Mr. Bean has accurately put forth to the Budget Committee what the line of communication is. He didn't say we're not going to give you the information we're looking for. He set up a framework where they could get it.
And I would just like to say that, and I'm not blaming Mrs. Latimer, because I know that she worked hard to do it, but she didn't. No one contacted me as a member of the board of as the chairman about it at all. And at my time with talking with Phil was just to affirm that this has been the way that we have done it. And I would like to just say that. Do we need to make a motion, or is a consensus enough that this is what how we did it last year and this year? We plan to do it this way again?
Or do we
need a motion?
I think the specific operationally, because it directly involves two of the departments you operate and also the manager's role, it would be helpful to affirm that the approach Mr. Bean has indicated to the Budget Committee is the representative of what a majority of this board feels is appropriate.
Okay. And I would just like to also say that if there are times when Mr. Bean isn't able to go to the Budget Committee, Mr. Bridle is the alternate, and he will gladly fill in at any time. So I would just like to point that out there. So did you want to make a motion?
I have a question for council.
Feel free.
Is it legally acceptable for some members of this five-member board to order an employee of this board to not appear before Budget Committee on the day of the actual committee meeting, when that meeting and his appearance was scheduled for the whole month ahead of time? First of all, I question the legality of leaving out at least one member of this board with that decision. Any decision, but in this particular instance, I believe it was flagrant. And I think if the policy of this board needs to be stated that we will do whatever with the Budget Committee. I have no problem with your statement about these committees and running around. You can't have people running around and disrupting departments. I agree with that. This was a single individual who had been booked on for the entire month.
We understand.
Well, you don't understand because you can't keep going behind my back.
Point of order,
Mr.
Chairman.
Just
a point of order, and just
a, right to know.
A point of order, Mr. Chairman. Please.
Right to know.
May I have a point of order? And equally in your response, Counselor, could you please address if it is not appropriate to assert a customary practice endorsed by the board and department heads? Conversely, what right does one member have to schedule that employee, that being Mrs. Woolsey, the month before she quit the budget committee.
I didn't schedule him.
Thank you.
Mrs. Latimer said, you don't have the floor, Mrs.
I told every one of you when you stopped the whole...
You don't have the floor, Mrs. Wolseley.
Too bad.
Yes, it is too bad.
I told all of you.
Mrs. Wolseley.
When you spent the whole last year complaining about the budget
you
committee.
You are out of line, Mrs. Wolseley.
Well, I
you
think
are
I
out
have
of
reason
line.
To be annoyed.
You are out of line.
I say what you did is illegal.
You are out of line.
Illegal.
We are here to do the town's business. If you'd like to be part of this board, you're always welcome. You are out of line now, and do we have a motion?
I want to hear counsel's answer, please.
I thought you gave it to her. I heard it.
I said what I think this board, it would be helpful if this board would vote to indicate that as Mr. Bean has articulated your approach to having people that work for you and work for the manager be coming to the budget committee's meeting that this board so indicate.
What about 91A?
I so move.
I second it.
All those in favor, unanimous.
No, it's not unanimous, and I want an answer.
Are you against it, or are you abstaining?
I am opposed.
Okay, so that is 4-1.
I want an answer, please, from council.
Mrs. Wolseley, you've got your answer.
I don't have an answer. I would like an answer from council on not including a member or possibly
Mrs.
members.
Mrs. Wolseley,
of the
we're
board.
Not going to beat a dead
In
horse
decision.
Here. We are
it's
going to move on
horse.
To business. Well, then you need to take it up with the attorney on your own
it's
time.
It's the law.
You can
no,
take care
I
of this.
No, I think I can ask council in public. He's here, and I'd like to ask council.
You already have asked him.
And I have not a reply under 91A. Is
Do you
every
have anything
member
else to
of
say?
This board entitled
Mr.
to
Gerald?
The same information?
I think whenever an attorney is asked a legal opinion that's directed toward a certain outcome, it's important to know all of the facts. The facts, as I heard them last week when you conferred on this subject, were that Mr. Bean had been given the authority as the board's representative to direct the responses of this board to the budget committee. That's what I heard last week.
When was that vote taken? Somebody that's, show me that in the minutes. When was
it
that
was
vote
a consensus.
Taken?
For the whole last year, that's how we operated,
no,
Mrs.
No,
Wolseley.
No. You're deliberately taking a vote on this now.
Oh, we are now because you're causing some issues
I am
here.
Not
you didn't complain all last year when it worked this way.
No, it didn't work this way, Mrs. Wolseley.
Okay, Mrs. Wolseley, we're moving on.
No,
we are moving on.
No, you
Mrs.
are not.
Mrs. Wolseley, we are moving on.
You have
on.
Not included me in the discussion in this particular instance, and that is a violation
we
of
just
91A.
Discussed it. You had your chance to say.
It's a violation of the statute.
You don't understand that you have. There's been a motion made and you voted against it.
Yes, I did.
Okay. That's all there is to it, Mrs. Wolseley.
And what happens next when you're doing something and you're not notifying me? Where do we go then?
Mrs. Wolseley, you seem to have a.
That's all right.
We're moving on. We have other business
eye.
To do, Mrs.
That's
Wolseley.
Fine.
And
right
your
ahead.
Assertions that other things are going on
you
are
never
absolutely
notified
wrong.
Me as chairman of this board. Never. And your job as chairman is to manage the entire board.
Mrs. Okay. Wolseley, I thought you were paying attention last year when you were here. But we will now, 10
to
is to return to recess public hearings of February 23rd for Lot B for continuation should the need arise. Anything further on that?
I believe council has information for the board. You had requested him to prepare something in the form of a motion and material, and I believe he's done that for you, as was directed.
Yes, prepared to make the motion. Is anybody alive? Okay. I hereby move to approve of the decision denying layout provided by town council as same reflects what the majority of the board discussed and voted on April 20th, 2015, and noting also that the petition for release of dedicated way filed by Attorney Durbin is also denied for the reasons stated in the decision. And I have the copy of the decision as coordinated by counsel with Attorney Laughlin, and I have read the entire decision.
I'll second that.
Okay. Any further discussion? All in favor?
I would just like to say that Attorney Gerald, like his performance tonight on this issue, he quarterbacked myriad attorneys on a seemingly complex land issue, and he did a fabulous job.
Did you want to say something, Mr. Wardell?
Yes, I have one question. Since I voted against it originally, I would just vote against it again. I mean,
You don't have to.
This is just accepting what you've.
It's reflecting the board's 3-2 vote. You can say it does, even though you may not agree.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor and against? And what is your vote?
I'm in favor of this, even though I was against it originally.
Thank you.
Okay. Do we have to sign?
Sure. There's a sheet for the board to sign.
Going to closing comments, Mr. Waddell.
Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry. May I just suggest that we go into a non-public session under RSA 91A:3(2)c)(e) to discuss matters which, if publicly discussed, might adversely affect the reputation of someone, or also include a discussion of litigation matters.
Does someone want to make that motion?
So moved.
And it would be a roll call vote.
Aye.
Second. Mr. Bean seconded, I guess. Yeah.
Aye.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, closing comments, Mr.
Yeah, I would just like to make the comment that we need to move ahead. I said this last week, and I will say it again this week, that, and I'm not going to get into any argument with anybody, there was no secret meeting. I've tried to explain to the individual who talked to me that there was no secret meeting. There was no secret meeting taking place on the election of the chairman of the board, and we really... There are much more important issues than to sit here and argue about foolishness. If an individual feels that there's a legal thing, then they should take whatever action they need necessary. But I think I would hope that this board moves on from that foolishness.
Mr. Bridle.
I totally agree with Jim Waddell in this situation. You know, a number of things have been said. It's time to move forward. It's time to move on. It was said that I said that there was a phone tree back at the March meeting, and I don't ever remember saying that. And I went through the tape twice, and that was not in there. But yet, it comes out in the newspaper that I've said some stuff that wasn't true. It's time to move forward and move on, and I think this board needs to do that.
I totally agree with both the other selectmen that just talked, and there has been no meetings. It's time to move on, to conduct business as necessary, and this paranoia that seems to be coming here at the board has got to stop. Mrs. Woolsey.
I just would like to be notified when someone is doing something, even if it's just a phone call.
Mr. Bean.
I should be notified.
Thank you. And that line of communication that counsel so aptly described and the board has supported will suffice for Selectman Woolsey's demands. And I would just ask you, Selectman Woolsey, to accord the chair of the selectmen of the town of Hampton. Rusty and I went to junior high school here. Rusty went to elementary. Our grandkids are here. Our families are here. Many people have moved into this town. Jim is a valued public servant. And the chairman of the Board of Selectmen is a servant of the people and a servant of this board. And I don't like the tone and demeanor. It's unprofessional, and it casts a seriously diminished pall over the effectiveness. And it has nothing to do with your leadership, which is fine. And I would say, lastly, to Selectman Woolsey, I just wish that you would rise to the level of cooperation where as little as 6 weeks ago you said this was the best board you ever worked with, and now we can do no right and we're having illegal phone conversations and disrupting the democratic process. And I would hope that you would rise to your potential and change heed with the concept that your board members have discussed tonight. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
How long would it have taken to pick up the phone and tell me what you were thinking?
Does someone want to make a
motion?
Do we have to make a motion?
Recess.
To recess.
I make a motion.
Okay.
Second.
All those in favor at 9... 39. Rusty, you want to pick the door for them? Please.